Ladies and gentlemen, on August 5th, 1994, the Knoxville Civic Coliseum was the site of one of the most legendary pro wrestling extravaganzas of all time, Night of the Legends. Let's go to ringside where Jim Ross and Les Thatcher call the action.
Knoxville, Tennessee, a river city rich in southern tradition, noted for many things. Neyland Stadium, the home of the University of Tennessee Volunteers. On game day, Neyland Stadium is the sixth largest city in the state. The beautiful steamships cruising down the Tennessee River. Knoxville is the gateway to the Great Smoky Mountains, one of the most beautiful locations on earth with millions of visitors every year. But Knoxville is also known for its professional wrestling. This is the Knoxville Civic Coliseum. For years, it played host to some of the most exciting wrestling matches ever held, featuring nearly every top athlete in our sport. On August 5th, 1994, Smoky Mountain Wrestling invited a record-breaking crowd to relive the glory years for a night of action, a night of emotion, a night of memories, the Night of the Legends.
Hello again, everybody, and welcome to Smoky Mountain Wrestling, a Night of Legends. We are in the Knoxville Civic Coliseum, a capacity crowd on hand. I'm Jim Ross, and as a wrestling fan, I wouldn't have missed this event for the world. And I'm certainly honored to have a great wrestling legend, Les Thatcher, here with us tonight as my broadcast colleague. Les, this is going to be a very special night.
Jim, it certainly is, and as you can hear by the electricity in the air, this is the greatest night in Knoxville wrestling history. We're all happy, the fans and myself, to have you on the mic with us tonight for this momentous occasion. And without further ado, let's let it roll.
Let's let it roll. Let's get started. We'll be back with all the action in just a moment.
Jim Cornette, Killer Kyle, you want to talk about who the strongest wrestler is? You want to talk about who the baddest guy is? Well, let me tell you something. If you're looking in the mirror, you ain't seeing the strongest guy in professional wrestling. You ain't even seeing the strongest guy in Smoky Mountain wrestling. Well, tonight, the Night of Legends, it's a great honor to be in Knoxville, Tennessee, and we're going to show you not only who the strongest guy in professional wrestling is, we'll show you who the best wrestler is.
This man is 4 weeks away from bodybuilding competition, if you will. He can't be more than single-digit body fat, Jim. And very, very quick, very explosive. He can beat you on the ground, he can beat you in the air, and he's getting this crowd in it right away. Quite a test for two very, very powerful men. As we said, Killer Kyle weighed in here at 305 pounds.
Curtis spotting him, a lot of weight, but certainly no strength.
Doug Furness will not be intimidated by Killer Kyle, I can assure you that. Collar and elbow tie-up. Already the men the test of strength here.
Kyle staggered back into the ropes. And look at the surprise on his face, being spotting a man that much weight, and still he can't out-muscle him.
Kyle certainly accustomed to outpowering the athletes that he competes with here in Smoky Mountain Wrestling, but Doug Furness is a different breed of athlete. Legitimately known as the strongest man in the world, and of course, Les, you're very familiar with his great track record in powerlifting.
Absolutely. 1986, 87, and 88, the Budweiser Hawaiian World Championships, Furness winning his division and overall totals in three lifts. And you notice in here, when these guys were doing their collar and elbow, tugging for position here, Jim, how Furness was dropping lower and bringing that center of gravity down and making Kyle, who's the taller man, come down and lose his balance, lose his center of gravity.
Greco-Roman knuckle lock here, another test of strength by these two athletes. And this should be most interesting.
Furness leaning in again, Kyle having to try to come down to Furness's level, and Furness with that advantage, Jim, Kyle struggling to maintain balance.
And Doug Furness with the advantage, much to the delight of this capacity crowd, has Killer Kyle down on one knee.
And you know, as we watch this test of strength, you mentioned the capacity crowd. We're talking about the balls and the ball fans. But I've talked to people here tonight from Tampa, Florida, Montreal, Quebec, Canada, and San Francisco, California.
All over North America, fans have traveled here to this beautiful city. And Doug Furness right back up after that hard slam. And I don't think Killer Kyle can quite believe
what he has seen, and he may be having some second thoughts about signing a contract here.
Look at that. Furnace able to maintain balance and watch him muscle him.
Oh, man. Great power slam by Doug Furnace down in that four-point stance. Killer Kyle losing his bandana. He may be prepared to lose more than that. What a shoulder block. And the velocity took Killer Kyle all the way up to the concrete floor.
And you know, if Jim Cornette, leader of the union, is watching this on a monitor somewhere, I'm sure he is a very distressed gentleman.
Cornette is easily distressed. And before this night is over, he may be more than distressed. This is the night we have all been waiting for. A night that will certainly make history in the annals of professional wrestling. Doug Furnace, talked to him earlier. Wouldn't have missed it for the world, I can tell you that. As he's preparing to go back to Japan in just a few weeks on another major tour.
Absolutely. You know, he's just home about 3 days now. So he's the last tour of the Orient.
Just perhaps getting over jet lag as he's wrenching that side headlock in. And Killer Kyle may get a gift of some cauliflowered ears before this one's said
and
done.
And Kyle may feel like he has jet lag before this evening is over.
Furnace with that low center of gravity, as you pointed out, Les. Really, he utilizes that to his advantage. And when he clamps that headlock on, it's reminiscent of the legends of the old days of the Ed Strangler Lewis, who was legendary for his side headlock. Even the great Oklahoman Danny Hodge, who was a master of the side headlock.
Another one of your fellow statesmen, and I can feel his power right now because I've tangled with that junior heavyweight champion right here in this Coliseum many years ago, Jim. There was a man who could break pliers with his grip only, crush apples. And Furnace displaying that same type of tenacious grip as he works on the ears and the head of Killer Kyle.
He's keeping it very, very basic, very fundamentally sound. Not taking any extra chances is Doug Furnace. He is originally from Commerce, Oklahoma. He also, another great athlete came from Commerce, Oklahoma by the name of Mickey Mantle.
Yes, I believe I've heard that name somewhere down the line. And Furnace may hit a home run here tonight again while we're doing analogies on different sports. You know, Kyle has yet to do much with this, and he is just being overpowered by Doug Furnace. I'm sure Kyle is as frustrated as he can get.
Well, good move there. Nice suplex. But look at Doug Furnace hold on to that side headlock. A suplex was nicely done by Kyle, but that's just another testament of the outstanding upper body strength in this particular occasion of Doug Furnace.
When you get a man that's deadlifting in the 700-800 pound range, squatting in the same place and bench pressing high fours and low fives, you got to realize what kind of power are in those arms.
Kyle now breaking the rules, going downstairs with the right hand to the face with another Irish whip coming at you here to the center of the ropes. The clothesline, and he caught him and dropped Doug Furnace, did Killer Kyle right across the top ring rope.
Kyle taking away the athlete's greatest asset, and that's his win, Jim.
Well, Kyle may be wasting some valuable time here because for the first time in the contest, he has the advantage.
Yes, he does, and instead of working to the crowd, he should be right on top of the ex-ball Doug Furnace. Furnace coming up slowly, but Jim, I'm not ready to count this tenacious Tennessee ball out.
Absolutely not. He doesn't know the word quit, I can tell you that. Kyle looks to be biting the man, and referee Mark Curtis admonishing Kyle. I don't think that's going to do a lot of good. I don't think his words will be heeded.
You know, I'm very surprised that Kyle hasn't used his own power now that he has Furnace off balance and does have the...
Whoa! What a great vertical suplex. Another, the second suplex of the match by Kyle. Perfectly done. This time he goes to the cover. One, two, and a half. A long two count.
Oh, Doug just out by the hair of his chinny chin chin on that one.
Well, I respect the tenacity of Killer Kyle, but in my book, it would be an upset if he defeats Doug Furnace here. Kyle, side slam. Another high impact move by this 305 pounder. Going for the cover. He's got the leg hook, but another two count.
You notice here, Kyle himself trying to stop Furnace, trying to keep him down, is becoming winded himself, although he still has maintained that offensive posture. But I don't know if maybe Kyle's inability to put him away may cost him in a few moments.
Doug Furnace back up to his vertical base. get hammered those hard right hands to the head. And Killer Kyle's hitting Doug Furness with just about all he's got. And he can't put the big man down. Killer Kyle, that clothesline, just bounced off that massive chest.
I can't believe Kyle standing, his arms at his sides. He is even...
Oh, my! Great belly-to-belly suplex. And Doug Furness planted Mark Killer Kyle here. Furness, now Irish Whip. He's picking up the pace, great dropkick. Found its mark list.
Yes, it did. And Doug Furness is right back in this, and he is controlling the offense in the power slam.
Another power slam, and a lateral press, and a two count. But that's all this time. Pace has quickened here. That's exactly what Furness wanted. Irish Whip far side, and as he rushed Killer Kyle, he got a foot right to the face. And a clothesline that almost took Doug Furness out of his boots.
Kyle seems to be getting a second wind here, and he is powering back and again is taking over. He has been able to stop Furness' attempt to put him away.
Doug Furness taking a lot of punishment here. Reverses the whip and caught him. And that modified Frankensteiner with a body scissors, and he's got it.
What a match to open this great card. It was back and forth, and Furness pulls it out of the air.
And your winner, ladies and gentlemen, Doug Furness.
Look at this crowd, Jim, on their feet. The Vol fans applauding and clapping hands with Doug Furness, your winner in our first match here at the Night of Legends.
Oh, just a couple of minutes. Dickie, I'm telling you, I'm just so excited. The Mongolian Stomper, Ronnie Garvin, never have they ever been a tag team before. And never will they ever be a tag team again after we get through with them. They're mean, tough, rough individuals. Yes, they are. But Dickie,
the only thing about Bob Orton and I, we always go forward, because when you start going backwards, you start feeling like the south end of that northbound mule. And then you know what that is? For you people out there that don't understand that, you start feeling like Aspen, Colorado. And I'm going to tell you something right now, Ronnie Garvin, Stomper, Bob Orton Jr. and I, our record goes way, way back. And nobody's ever taken us in the ring and put our shoulders down to the mat. We don't even care about the shoulders being down anymore. We just want to fight. It's like not driving a go-kart. It's like the Indianapolis 500. And this is what it's going to be like. The big one, my friend.
Oh, that's great. And I'm sure all those people are sitting there, well, how can these two fellas be standing there smiling? Well, you might know about the south end and northbound mules. But we're excited and smiling because we love to fight, Daddy. And the fight's on.
In just a few minutes, you know what we're going to be doing? We're going to step in a ring with Bob Orton and Dick Slater. Yeah, they're probably the two toughest individuals on the circuit. But I'm going to tell you something. You're looking at one of the craziest son of a... I ain't going to finish a sentence, but I'm just as crazy as he is. We're going to use the furniture in 5 minutes from now. Knoxville's not going to be the same. The Coliseum's not going to be the same. Dick Slater and Bob Orton Jr. ain't gonna be the same. There's gonna be some furniture. They're gonna pick wood out of their heads. They're gonna pick their teeth out of the mat. And they're gonna pick their booty out of the commode, because we're gonna drive them all over this building. So get ready. You think I've lost it? Yeah, I've lost it years ago right here in this Coliseum when I fought this guy. Now he's gonna be behind me and I'm gonna be behind him. I don't know who's gonna be behind, but we're gonna kick some booty. You understand here?
Bill Rainey unable to finish what he was about to say, but Jim, the referee, is also a legend. Mr. Mac McMurray.
And the action is starting out here. Ronnie Garvin and Dick Slater. Garvin with a headbutt, Slater up on that top rope. The Mongolian Stomper and Cowboy Bob Orton in the far corner. And Orton right outside on the floor. And this one is wild and crazy already. And Slater and Orton have got to regroup less.
We're talking about how these four men may compete together. I think analogy may be, Jim, that if you're recasting One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, you could start with these four grapplers right here.
Well, Slater threw a chair in the ring, and now they're all four outside.
Stomper and Slater right in front of us, but look across the ring at Garvin and Orton Jr.
And Slater's shoulder goes right into the ring post. Marvin and Orton on the far side. Man, this one is physical. You gotta wonder. I know these four guys are in great shape, but how long can this one last, starting out so intensely?
Absolutely. There will be no textbook wrestling in the Legends Tag Match. Look at Garvin. This is a man who loves weapons. If he could pick this ring up, he'd be hitting somebody over the head with that, Jim.
Garvin has spilled a lot of blood, as has the Mongolian Stomper in this very arena, but I guess we could say the same for all four of these athletes.
Yes, sir. I remember the Stomper's first appearance here in a two-ring battle royal on New Year's Day in 1976. This building was stunned by the ferocity of the Mongolian Stomper.
Known for a very feared maneuver called the Shinanamaki that many other wrestlers have attempted to duplicate over the years in various names, but by any name, it was perfected by the Mongolian Stomper. It will be Ronnie Garvin and Cowboy Bob Orton, and Orton wants Garvin to step a little closer in that corner, but Garvin's not going to fall for that.
We're talking about veterans, ring-wise, ring-savvy. You've got four of the best right here.
Garvin with a handful of hair takes Orton down face first. Hard right hand. And good teamwork there by Garvin and the Stomper as Orton's head rammed into the foot of the Mongolian Stomper. And Orton all the way outside, falling right on the back of his head, right out here on the concrete floor.
Is Orton down to stay? I don't know yet, Jim. Certainly he took a hellacious bang on that concrete floor. As you mentioned earlier, there is no padding around this ringside.
You know what, I'm amazed and very, it's amazing how well these four veterans, what great shape they seem to be in, Les.
You're absolutely right. It looks like we have just turned the clock back 15 years, and these four guys are as fresh as the day they first stepped into a wrestling ring.
Especially Cowboy Bob Orton, who looks to be maybe even a little leaner than in his peak years. And here comes the unpredictable one, Dick Slater.
You know, when I watch Dick Slater, you may have made the same comparison, Jim. He reminds me so much in his manner and style in that ring of another man on this card tonight, one Terry Funk.
Both unpredictable, both very volatile individuals. As the collar and elbow tie up, Slater with the advantage, forcing Garvin back into the ropes now. Slater with a 25-pound weight advantage. Irish whip to the far side. Misses that right hand, but Garvin didn't miss his. And Garvin waistlocks him and takes him down in the atomic drop. Right into the arms of the Mongolian Stomper, who snaps Slater's neck right off the top rope. And Slater slithers like a snake back to his corner. And he went a little too far.
Would you say that for me six more times? Slither like a snake. Look at these guys go. And this match has been 100% full speed, Jim, since we rang the bell.
Oh, my! The whip at the first. And the Mongolian Stomper really asserting himself. Top, and down goes Orton.
I tell you what, I can tell you from experience, this Stomper is conditioned. He can go 100% wide open for the whole duration of this match if need be. And I've also felt the wrath of those hands of stone, and I'm starting to ache just thinking about it.
A little miscue there. And Orton dropped out of sight, and the Mongolian Stomper nailed his partner inadvertently, but he did nail it. And look at Slater now trying to egg him on as if it were intentional.
And I think Slater and Orton would like nothing better than for these two guys to get into it. It would make it much easier for them.
And they tempers are flaring now. We know the rivalry that exists between these two guys. Oh, God! And they turn right around and nail their opponents with right hand. And Orton and Slater are still in trouble. They've got them cornered. Nowhere to go for Orton and Slater.
And these two guys who were so anxious to take this battle to the middle of that ring moments ago are looking for a timeout here, Jim, and I don't blame them.
Fans here from all over North America, photographers, reporters from Japan, all here to see this phenomenal night of the legends. And good teamwork now. It looks like Garvin and the Stomper are right back on the same page.
Shoots Orton. Oh, got that sleeper. This could be it right here.
One of Ronnie Garvin's favorite maneuvers, that sleeper hold. And he's got to lock in quite well. Orton made the, he drove his head right up to the jaw of Garvin in a very unique counter move. Well, these veterans just You know, a counter for the counters, it would
Absolutely. Seem. It's beautiful to watch them, Jim, because you never count them out until you hear that three count toll and the bell ring. They can always counter and reverse something.
Tag has been made. Dick Slater in. The hard kick right to the head of Ronnie Garvin.
And, of course, I think they would prefer keeping Garvin in there because the juggernaut in the other corner, if he cuts loose again, could turn the tide of battle.
And the referee having to restrain the Mongolian Stomper. In the meantime, Cowboy Bob Orton unleashing some wicked right hands on Ronnie Garvin. And down goes Garvin, who's in a great deal of trouble, far, far from his corner.
Orton has always been able to throw that punch well, and this elbow of Slater's.
He's off the cover. One, two. And Slater wanted a little faster count from our official.
It takes a lot more than an elbow and a couple punches to put Garvin down to stay, and they're going to find that one out.
Swinging neck breaker, nicely done by Dick Slater. And Slater now driving that elbow once again viciously into running Garvin. One, two, and Garvin has a foot on the ropes. That stops the count.
Slater and Orton, you know, have been several regional tag team champions over the years. They're doing what good tag team champions or good tag teams do, keeping their opponent on their side of the ring. It's much tougher to tag unless you got an arm 10 feet long, Jim.
Well, they made the legal tag, but Slater got a cheap shot in before he left, which certainly infuriated the Mongolian Stomper, who seems to be just about ready to explode.
Stomper doesn't like staying away from the action. He is ready, believe me. But yet, look at Orton.
Orton, he knows every trick in the book, literally. Hard elbow, he saw it right to the throat. He didn't go for the face, he went right for the throat.
And there's a man who was one of the great junior college amateur wrestlers in his day, Bobby Orton Jr.
Certainly was. And look at the position now that Ronnie Garvin is under, and he got hung off the bottom ring rope there. That cable caught him in the throat again, and Garvin is gasping for air as he would love to make a tag to the Mongolian Stomper. Here comes Dick Slater, and Slater nails the Stomper and pulls Garvin back into the far corner.
Now you talk about good ring strategies. Slater and Orton, as you can tell, Jim, as we both know, are like well-oiled machines working together as a tandem.
Double teaming is Slater and Orton on a weakened Ronnie Garvin. And Garvin desperately needs to make a tag here at his earliest opportunity.
And, of course, I think the more you pound on Ronnie Garvin, the more he tries to battle back. And right now I think it's instinct that's driving him toward that corner and the outreached hand of the Mongolian Stomper.
Almost a burst of the camel clutch there for a moment. I thought he was going to set back on it.
Yes, exactly. Look at Garvin walking him leg by leg, Jim.
Garvin's got a turn, and he does. He turns and faces his corner. The shortest distance between two points is that old proverbial straight line, and that's exactly where Garvin wants to go.
The tag is made.
He made the tag. I don't think, no, the referee, I don't think, saw it. The referee did not see the tag. He can't call what he doesn't see. And double vertical suplex by Orton and Slater, and this may be all for Garvin. Bad break for Garvin the Stomper. It may be over. At least Orton thinks it is. One, two, and that's all.
And Orton is as surprised as can be with that one.
And Orton get himself between Garvin and the Mongolian Stomper. That's a great veteran move a lot of youngsters can learn from.
Yes, sir. As I said earlier, it may not be textbook wrestling per se as the whole, Jim, but you're right. A lot of young men can watch these champions.
Made the tag that time. I don't think the referee saw it.
No, he didn't catch it. He's going to put the Stomper out.
And look at the back breaker by Orton and the elbow by Slater. And again, Ronnie Garvin has been decimated here. One, two, and a shoulder comes up.
And of course, if there is an edge here, it's the fact that Slater and Orton have wrestled as a team many, many times. And if we haven't mentioned it before, arch enemies for many years were Garvin and the Stomper, and the first time in wrestling history in this ring, they are teamed here tonight in the Night of Legends, Jim.
I've seen some photographs of some real bloodbaths that the Stomper and Garvin have had.
Oh, yes.
In this great state. And a right hand by Garvin. Man, he will never quit. I'll guarantee you that. He will never give it up. He blocks the right by Slater and comes back with a right of his own. And another right hand, and Slater is in deep trouble here.
And
Garvin,
he
tried to go between the legs, and Slater sensed it. And wrapped him up.
Yes, good drop, and Slater blocked him beautifully. You've got basically four of the best back alley brawlers of the mid-70s to mid-80s right here in this ring. And of course, we haven't mentioned that Ronnie Garvin at one time was the NWA World Heavyweight Champion.
I saw him win the championship as he defeated the legendary Ric Flair for the NWA title in one of the most physical matches that I have ever witnessed in my life.
And if I recall, you were on the mic that night, were you not?
I certainly was. Front face lock applied by Sturdy Dick Slater, the unpredictable one. And look at Garvin. He's got to make that tag. He made the tag, and the referee saw it this time. The referee saw it, and the Mongolian Stomper in, and nothing but fists.
The Stomper battling away now, and we've got all four wrestlers in the ring. This is not something, Jim, I would want to be the referee in. He has no control of these guys.
Mongolian Stomper's got that boot off. And that's a trademark of his. He's got that boot off. The referee's been knocked down. Referee's been abused here. Referee's called it for the bell. The Stomper's got that boot off like a weapon. He's hitting anything that moves. And outside goes Orton. And now Slater in there at both of them. Slater being pummeled.
Orton out here looking for a weapon. He's found it and ring announcer Bill Rainey's chair. But Garvin has intercepted the chair, Jim.
The referee once again calling for the bell. What a fight we have seen here between these four legends, and they're ready for more.
And it has been called a
ladies and gentlemen, referee McMurray disqualified both teams. This match, no contest.
A double disqualification, and for these guys, as the old saying goes, it's just like kissing your sister, Jim.
The fire still burns deeply within the souls of these four gallant, courageous athletes.
And there you have it. We've taken you back in time with our Legends Tag Match, and it is a double disqualification, no contest.
Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, I would like to interview the most controversial team in any wrestling federation. They have caused more controversy by the spoken word than any team in the world of professional wrestling. At this time, let's bring out New Jack and Mustafa Saeed, the Gangstas. Gentlemen, the reason that we have asked you to join us at this time is that in recent weeks, Smoky Mountain Wrestling has received a great deal of complaints from the great television stations that air the broadcast, from the wrestling fans, and even from the Knoxville chapter of the NAACP. I am here to advise you, as a representative of Smoky Mountain Wrestling, that from now on, all of your interviews will have a disclaimer. The television stations and Smoky Mountain Wrestling are not going to be responsible for what you're saying on your interviews. And if you go over the line, then you will be censored. I'm sure you have some statements regarding this situation.
Let me tell you something. First of all, I'm gonna give you redneck hillbilly the privilege of seeing me here. You understand? Now, it seems like every time you get one of us that want to be outspoken, you want to silence them. You silence Martin Luther King, you understand? You silence Mega Evers, and now you even try to silence Arsenio Hall. You took him off the air. Well, baby, I'm here, and I'm going to be here until I feel like I want to leave. And if you don't like me being here, train to be a professional wrestler, get in this ring, and I'll beat you like I own you. I don't care nothing about these hillbillies not liking me. I don't care nothing about these hillbillies putting a censor on what I say and what I do. I've been censored all my life. So what do you think I care about these fools up here gonna try to do something to me? Let me tell you, and I tell Smoky Mountains, and especially I'm gonna send a message out to the NAACP. A bunch of trained Negroes, as you call them, you understand? Y'all got them where you want them. You got these Negroes from the NAACP in a cage. You tell them to jump, they say, well, hi, Master Jones, with New Jack, you don't care how far to jump, because I tell you to drop dead, you understand? I'm gonna do what I wanna do. NAACP, what they call them? National Association of Colored People. First of all, you get them, they say, don't call a black man colored. But then they gonna sell out to y'all. I'm not selling out to y'all. If you don't like me, the hell with all of you. Because if you wanna get something going with me, you ain't got to be trained to be a wrestler. Get your ass in here, and I'll beat you like I own you. Now, what you think about that?
Well, I have one more question to ask you, and I'll do it with respect. Perhaps you'll answer me with respect, and these great fans here. What exactly is your objective here in Smoky Mountain Wrestling?
Everywhere we have ever went, we done beat people until we got tired of beating them. Then one day somebody said, well, we know somebody you hadn't beat yet. I said, who? I said, it can't be nobody from South Central LA, because we whooped all them to death. I said, who? They said, the Rock and Roll Express. I done beat brothers that have been in jail for murder. I have beat brothers that's done been in jail for molesting their own kid. I done beat brothers that's done been in jail for stealing cars. The only thing the Rock and Roll Express has done, which I'll give them credit where it's due, they done beat Doom, they beat the Steiners, they beat the Road Warriors, they done beat all the top dogs wrestling, but never have they been in a fight. You understand? True enough, they might beat us wrestling, but a fight. I'm talking about an eye gouging, hair pulling, teeth being knocked out, fight with no rules. They hadn't been in that yet. And until them rednecks get in here with me, I don't consider them top dog, because they got to survive this butt whooping that they gonna get from the gangsters. Like me or not, I don't care if you like me, because I don't like none of y'all either. The ones of you that don't smell like tobacco spit smell like coal. So hey, I'll say this from the bottom of my heart. Smoky Mountain fans, TV producers, the NAACP sellouts, kiss my black ass. And that's the bottom line. What you think about that?
All right, well, I'm gonna say this. There's no way you can say that New Jack is not outspoken. If he's looking for controversy, Jim has just joined me back here at ringside. He has found all he wants, Jim.
Well, I've conducted a lot of interviews in my career, but I have never been involved with anything quite like what I have just experienced. And I know that those views do not reflect those of Smoky Mountain Wrestling, nor the television station. Those were strictly the views of New Jack, Mustafa Saeed, better known as the Gangsters.
You know, I hope everybody's happy. I hope everybody is just peachy thrilled. Because tonight, at the Night of the Legends, my boys have yet another title defense against the Rock and Roll Express. But this time, tonight, I can't stand outside the ring and cheer them on. I can't stand outside the ring and give them a little help when they need it. God knows they don't need it. They can do it all their own. But tonight, I have to stand outside the ring, and I have to be handcuffed to Ricky Gibson, Robert Gibson's brother, the genetic defect himself, the little pervert. I don't know what he's going to try. try to do to me. So while my boys are wrestling, I have to worry about Ricky Gibson. And my boys have to worry about Rick Gibson doing something to me, too. Brian, please don't let him do anything.
They're not going to do anything. You know what? Does she look like a common criminal? No. You know, myself and Chris, we can handle handcuffs. But you're going to put a handcuff around this little fragile wrist? Big men. I'll tell you what, big men. We're going to take you out tonight, 1, 2, 3. Ricky Gibson, Robert Gibson, Ricky Morton, we don't care. It's time to draw the line. And tonight we're drawing the line in Knoxville. Isn't that right, Chris?
You know, tonight is the night of the legends. And Rock and Roll Express, you guys don't even belong in the ring. You guys are legends. We all know it.
Right.
You guys belong in the Hall of Fame. So why don't you go sit next to all those rickety, crippled up old men out there? That's where you belong. You don't belong in the ring with the two greatest stars of the day, Brian Lee and myself. So tonight, the night of legends, we're putting you guys into retirement, and we're keeping these Smoky Mountain Tag Team Championships.
In just a few short minutes from now, the night of legends, myself and Robert Gibson are going to step in the ring with Tammy Finch and Brian Lee and Chris Candido. You see, every time we had a match with these guys, it seemed Tammy Finch always wanted to interfere. But you see, Tammy, I told you a long time ago to be careful whose toes you step on your way up, because it might be connected to the ass that you got to kiss on your way back down. Because remember one thing tonight, Tammy Finch, we have one thing going for us. Tonight, and I have the honor right now to introduce them to everybody, is you're going to be handcuffed to the legend himself, the brother of Robert Gibson, Ricky Gibson, which everybody here in this area all know of. Ricky, come on in right now, buddy.
Let me say something, brother. You know, tonight's a special night, night of the legends. I am greatly and proud to be a legend, but tonight's going to be one of my special nights. My brothers here have been going for the belts, and it seems like every darn time there's something that falls in the way. Well, like I said, tonight's a special night, but it's going to be one of the special ones for me, because I'm going to see, brother, if she wants to do anything she wants. You can go ahead and try, but let me tell you one thing. You're handcuffed to me, and a legend has experience. I know what I'm doing. Brother.
And there you have it from us, the Rock and Roll Express.
Just a phenomenal ovation for the Rock and Roll Express here.
You know, sometimes I think I got the greatest job in the world, especially for this one occasion right here. Because who I'm fixing the noose right now is the man that stood behind the Rock and Roll Express ever since we tied on our first bandana. And he come here tonight for one thing only. That's to make it 2-on-2. Ladies and gentlemen, let me introduce to you the legend himself, Mr. Ricky Gibson.
And indeed, legend Ricky Gibson will be handcuffed to Miss Tammy Finch at ringside.
Ricky Gibson, the brother, the older brother of Robert Gibson of the Rock and Roll Express. Ricky involved in a very serious car accident not that long ago. But he wouldn't have missed this situation for the world. No matter how he had to get here, he was going to be here. He's here now, and he has a big responsibility. His job will be to keep Miss Tammy Finch minding her manners.
You know, Jim, some people may think that would be a job they'd want unless they've seen Miss Tammy Finch at work. This lady has schmoozed so many men in this area. She has pulled the wool over the eyes of Ron Wright, of so many guys. You wonder, besides that lovely figure, what the lady has going for her.
Well, she's awfully, I would say, very manipulative. Very shrewd. She's a businesswoman. She is a woman of the 90s. She's a very highly educated, very well-schooled young lady. Certainly has her goals set and knows exactly what she wants. Now, what she's going to get here, Les, is not what she wants, and that's to be handcuffed for Ricky Gibson.
Boy, that's a statement of fact. And another thing you may be noticing now, she's a little bit spoiled, Jim.
Oh, look at this. Well, she got the hook, and now she is... She should be, ladies and gentlemen, absolutely no factor in this contest, and it should be 2-on-2, and perhaps we will see the best team win.
I hope so. And of course, I'm sure she's thinking right now, I never wore a bracelet like this at Wellesley. And indeed, I'm sure she hasn't. And of course, you were talking about the legendary R&R Express. These guys have held the World Tag Team title. And of course, these titles right here on several occasions. And I know they are really gunning to get them back here tonight.
They've been, I saw them win the Mid-South Wrestling Tag titles down in Louisiana. I saw them pack 25 to 30,000 people in the Superdome, the Orange Bowl. They just got back on a very impressive tour of the Far East. They've been in Europe. This is a legendary team, no doubt about it.
Yes, sir. And speaking of longevity in terms of the way the fans have stuck by their side so very, very long, we're going to see, we saw a great Legends tag match. Now we're going to see of the modern age, two ring-wise young veterans in the Rock and Roll Express and two young men who have certainly carved a quick niche in this sport. That is Chris Candido and Brian Lee.
And there you see, sitting at ringside, Ricky Gibson handcuffed to Tammy Fitch. It will be Chris Candido and Robert Gibson starting it out here. The Smoky Mountain Wrestling Tag Team Championship is on the line, and we are underway. Little collar and elbow tie up, side headlock, good chain wrestling maneuvers, but a quick waist lock go behind by Robert Gibson, and Candido quickly makes his way to the ropes.
You know, one of the things I want to say about Chris Candido that impressed me about this young man from New Jersey, Jim, is the fact he's a throwback in many ways to wrestlers of 20 years ago, some of the guys we're going to see in the Legend presentation tonight, and yet he has every modern move of any young man his age for today.
He comes from a tough neighborhood there in Asbury Park, New Jersey. That's the hometown of another great competitor by the name of Bam Bam Bigelow.
Yes, sir. And they do come tough from Joyce.
Right hand slammed by Candido, and he's going to take a chance already. He's climbing up top, but Robert Gibson is up on his feet. And Gibson, oh my! He dropped, picked him right off the top, right out here by us on the concrete floor. You'll find no tumbling mats out here. He hit that concrete, and he is really in trouble at high elevation with that body drop. Robert Gibson has firmly asserted himself in the early going of this title match.
And in a quick couple moments, he certainly has taken offensive control. But look at Candido.
And he is resilient. Reversal of the Irish whip. Candido put on the brakes. Trying to outkick Robert Gibson. And the veteran caught him in the side headlock, but not for long. Good circle block by Gibson, and down goes Candido.
Again, these high flyers are moving faster than you can call the action.
Brian Lee got tagged with a right hand by Robert Gibson. And Gibson catapulted Candido outside, up and over the top. Good thing for Candido, his partner was there, but you see where they land, again, right out here in the concrete floor.
And this Coliseum are getting their money's worth tonight, Jim. Every match has been stellar. It has been a main event. And we're getting a look now at two blondes handcuffed, one legend, Ricky Gibson, and the other, Miss Tammy Fitch.
Well, Brian Lee looks like he is headed toward the house. And Candido looking back, and here comes Brian Lee back. Brian Lee's about 6'6 or 6'7, 290. He's a big, rugged individual.
The champions are a bit discouraged early on, which doesn't bode well for the title holders.
But you know, Brian Lee having some words with one of Knoxville's finest, and that's a proposition that I don't think he's going to win.
No, that man has a license to do what's necessary. And he doesn't abide by Smoky Mountain's rules of the ring.
And Brian Lee not intimidating that police officer. I'll tell you something. The situation here is that they have the advantage to the champions. They've got to lose by pinfall or submission here.
Absolutely.
And they're wasting a lot of time out here on the outside trying to frustrate the Rock and Roll Express, and that will not happen.
Brian Lee seems very disoriented, Jim, as he stalks the outside of the ring and seems to be looking for something, and yet I can't decide what that must be. He better be looking for some competition in that ring if they're going to maintain those titles.
Well, he is very distracted, is Brian Lee, and the Smoky Mountain Wrestling Tag Team Champions have not had a very auspicious start here. Tag made. Robert Gibson tags in Ricky Morton. Good move there by Gibson, a bulldog headlock from the legal man in the ring. Ricky Morton, Candido in trouble.
And of course, that move right there shows you why.
Okay. Morton goes for the cover, and Brian Lee try to kick Morton, but he kicked his own partner inadvertently. Morton with the right hands, and once again, Candido meets the concrete outside. Brian Lee tossed outside by Ricky Morton, and the challengers are owning the champions at this point in time.
Whoa! Ricky Gibson with a shot with that cane, Jim, to the head of Brian Lee. And as you said, the challengers are owning this thing. But of course, it only tells us more what a great team Ricky and Robert are and have always been.
I would think that the absence of Miss Finch in their corner may have a bigger effect. Apparently it does, at least that's my observation, Les, on the champions than perhaps we thought before this match started.
I would agree, Jim. And of course, she doesn't get physically involved that much. She does pass objects. But yet, you're right, I think these two guys are looking for guidance, and look at this shot of Miss Tammy Fitch. She is near tears at ringside.
Very, very upset, very distraught that she is having to sit down and be a little more ladylike, shall I say.
Very little, but yes, she's having to behave herself for one time when she's at ringside.
Big Brian Lee has that right hand taped, and he is not afraid to use it. He has a huge advantage in size and strength over Ricky Morton here, but this is not Ricky Morton's first dance. He's faced these odds before.
Yes, he has, and faced them many, many times, only to come out the winner. Look here, I think Brian Lee right now is spending more time stalling, trying to figure out how to handle these guys.
Well, I hate to see Ricky go to Fist City with this big guy. He's quicker, as we can see, singing left and right, and Morton explodes with a flurry on Brian Lee. Lee didn't expect that. He bails out on it outside, and again the Rock and Roll Express completely out-quicking the champions.
You might compare that to Sugar Ray Leonard punching on George Foreman. Before he could get his hands up, he had hit him 10 times.
He certainly did. And Brian Lee has got to get back in there and slow this thing down. They've got to be able to, as you mentioned earlier in tag team action, the strategy is to isolate your opponent, get one of them in your half of the ring. And they, the champions, have been unable to do that as of yet.
They have been able to get a hold and hang on to it for more than 10 seconds here, Jim. And I am amazed because, obviously, as the champions, they do know what they're doing in that ring. But they are facing, if you open the dictionary to tag team, you might find a picture of Ricky and Robert.
Well, I've seen a lot of great teams, Les, and I know you have as well. And I, as I said earlier, I've never seen, look at it, Miss Finch is very, very upset. And I can't say that my heart goes out to her, but
no.
In any event, I've never seen a team like Morton and Gibson that think as one as well as they do.
You're absolutely right, and there's almost times that you feel that the one on the outside knows what's happening before it happens on the inside, and he's right there to cover.
There you see the power. Primetime Brian Lee, hard slam, and Morton's quickness is not evident right here, but he got right back to his feet. Maybe he was playing a little possum there. I don't know.
Ooh.
Tag was made. Oh, they're making a wish, and it's not even Thanksgiving.
Oh-ho!
Big right hand, and Candido back down on the floor.
You talk about synchronized tag team work. You've seen it right here.
Good slam there by Gibson. Hard knee drive right to the chest of primetime Brian Lee, and another quick tag. Rock and Roll Express had made many, many quick tags, and he stretched those hamstrings. Candido back up on the apron. He thought he avoided him once, but he did, but not twice.
They're not only out wrestling him, they're out thinking him, Jim.
Well, maybe, just maybe, this is the night for the Rock and Roll Express. He's got his cradle. One, two.
And you know, sitting here thinking about it, Robert Gibson's adrenaline has to be pumping a little harder tonight with his brother at ringside for the first time in many moons, Jim.
You're absolutely right about that. Big brother sitting out here at ringside. Great to see Ricky. Haven't seen Ricky. I was very saddened to hear about his car accident. But he's making a great recovery, and we're very happy to see him here, especially in his role tonight.
Yes, he's...
Oh, my. Look at the strength here. Now, that is power, ladies and gentlemen. That is power. And Ricky Morton just was slammed very, very viciously right on the canvas. And Brian Lee spitting on Robert Gibson. That's uncalled for.
And we may look back on that move right there as being the turning point in this match where the champions finally come up with an offensive advantage.
Well, Ricky Morton's lower back has got to be some muscle spasms or something here. Candido going for the cover, and he got two. And Ricky Morton, with all the guts of a 400-pound man, able to kick out. Candido ricking the eye. Didn't care if the referee saw it or not. Now cheap shot, and Robert Gibson knocked off the apron. And the referee's got to put Robert out, and in the meantime, it's going to give the champions the opportunity to double team. And look, right off the top rope came the 290-pound primetime Brian Lee.
And they are certainly trying to make up for lost time now. They are in the driver's seat, and Jim, they've got a lot of ground to make up.
Candido with a slam. They have isolated Ricky Morton from his corner. They are focusing on Ricky Morton. They are focusing on his lower back. The Smoky Mountain Wrestling Tag Team Champions have finally got on the offensive, and they're really taking advantage here. Uh-oh, this could be a slingshot maneuver. Brian Lee came off the top, caught Morton with that fist right to the face. I don't think he got all that he wanted, but he got enough.
And Robert Gibson on the apron trying to stir up a little adrenaline for his partner as the fans come up en masse and start the chant.
Look at Ricky Morton fight back with all he's got. Fighting, right hand, fighting again, out of that corner. Morton now back and can't get to the far side. Irish whip is going to be reversed. And he caught him coming out. Oh, what a power slam. Great offensive move by a very resilient and very mentally tough Chris Candido.
Now, these guys have got the advantage, Jim, but look here. They have slowed the pace down. They're spending too much time gloating over this advantage. It could cost the champions once again.
Uh-oh. Ricky Morton again.
Look here!
Robert Gibson intercepted the move.
Brian Lee tripped over him. Look here!
What did he get? He got a two. Did he get it? No, he didn't. He got a two count. I thought they had it right there. Brian Lee completely surprised that Ricky Morton would hook the leg right there. He did so and got a near fall.
I think the champions are such a haste to make up for lost time that they made a very, very crucial mistake there, Jim.
And here's a double team. Again, Ricky Morton unable to get out of that corner. Here comes Robert Gibson, his partner. Robert Gibson's got to get his partner back in his corner, and he does so. He hit-bucked his own partner back in the corner to make the tag.
And here we go. Watch him roll. This man is on fire.
Gibson, high back body drop on Candido. Primetime Brian Lee. Tammy Fitz trying to fight her way up on the apron, but Ricky Gibson pulls her back down. Over the top of Robert Gibson. The referee didn't see it. That would have been a disqualification.
I think Tammy had some of her infamous hairspray, and it looked like Ricky grabbed it away and pitched it into the crowd. Look here.
Robert Gibson, oh my. He pushed Candido off. Candido is a partner. Morton got the cover. And three.
And we have new champions, Jim Ross. The Rock and Roll Express have done it again.
The Rock and Roll Express.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of the match and the new Smoky Mountain Tag Team Champions, the Rock and Roll Express.
They did it, ladies and gentlemen. The Rock and Roll Express have once again become Smoky Mountain Wrestling Tag Team Champions, and this capacity crowd loves it.
Yes, as Morton says often himself, he didn't come to play, he came to stay.
The champions once again are ecstatic.
All right, we done it, but don't forget tomorrow night. Fall on the Mountain. My hair against yours, Tammy Fitch. And you might walk into Johnson City looking like Crystal Gale, but you're gonna leave looking like Kojak.
And of course, Ricky Morton alluding to tomorrow night's Fire on the Mountain, the hair versus hair match. But again, they have won the Smoky Mountain titles in a great battle.
Ladies and gentlemen, over the past several weeks here on Smoky Mountain TV, the fans have been treated to a history of Knoxville wrestling hosted by my colleague, Les Thatcher.
And before we go any further, let's bring you up to date on how pro wrestling in Knoxville has evolved.
Knoxville, Tennessee, a historic city with many types of sports and entertainment. There's UT football, hockey, the Knoxville Zoo. But for almost 50 years, one of the top drawing attractions in this great city has been professional wrestling. Through many promotions, many various top stars, through good and bad times, one thing has been very, very consistent. Knoxvillians love their wrestling. On August 5th, Smoky Mountain Wrestling will be presenting a special night at the Knoxville Civic Coliseum, the Night of Legends, a celebration of the history of wrestling in Knoxville. Appearing will be many of the great stars who have been here over the years live to be inducted into the Knoxville Wrestling Hall of Fame. On this segment each week, we'll be updating you on what great stars will be appearing here in the Coliseum on August the 5th. Wow, this sure brings back a lot of memories and a few aches and pains. I have seen this when they were hanging from those railings up there at the top of this place. You know, a brief history of Knoxville wrestling is in order. I've been very lucky and fortunate for over 25 years to be a part of the wrestling scene here in Knoxville as a wrestler, a commentator, and a television producer. Many of the people we will be seeing on this program and in the Coliseum on August the 5th are personal friends and colleagues of mine. And of course, many of you grew up here in Chilhowie Park, coming here to the amphitheater or over there to the Jacobs Building, watching us professional wrestlers. Wrestling in Knoxville actually began at the old Lyric Theater on Gay Street in the 30s and 40s. But in the late 1950s, Knoxville got televised wrestling. A live program emanated from the studios of WBIR TV Channel 10, hosted by Rex Rainey and promoter John Kazana. Kazana Productions brought stars such as Tojo Yamamoto, Len Rossi, Don and Al Green, Corsica Joe, and many, many more to Chilhowie Park. By 1969, the wide world of wrestling, hosted by Big Jim Hess, came to WTVK, the old Channel 26. If you were a wrestling fan then, here's what you saw on Saturday afternoon.
Productions presents The Wide World of Wrestling.
Good evening. It's 6:30 and time for The Wide World of Wrestling. I'm John Kazana, along with Jim Hess, inviting you to stay with us for the next 1 hour.
The stars were legendary names in East Tennessee. Perennial Tennessee Tag Team Champions Ron and Don Wright, Sam Bass, Ken Lucas, Dennis Hall, Johnny Walker, Ed Wolf, Tommy Gilbert, Bulldog Frank Morrell, Jim White, and my favorite tag team, myself and the late legendary Whitey Caldwell. Wrestling set attendance records in the Chilhowie Park Amphitheater and attracted such attention that the world champions came here to face the best. Lou Thesz defended against Ron Wright, and Dory Funk Jr. battled Whitey Caldwell. In 1974, one era came to an end and another began. Kazana Productions was sold out and brought to an end 40 years of the Kazana family involvement in professional wrestling here. On next week's Legends Update, we'll talk to you about the wrestling promotion that became the stellar attraction in this area, Southeastern Championship Wrestling. In last week's history of Knoxville Wrestling, we brought you up to 1974, when promoter John Kazana sold out to Southeastern Championship Wrestling. That began a new era in Knoxville Wrestling, and many of the top grapplers from around the world made their appearances here in Chilhowie Park, and then later in the Knoxville Civic Coliseum, where wrestling still holds the all-time attendance record. Southeastern Championship Wrestling featured such stars as Ron and Robert Fuller, World Junior Heavyweight Champion Nelson Royal, Dutch Mantell and John Foley, Ricky Gibson, One Man Gang Ronnie Garvin, the Mongolian Stomper, Professor Boris Malenko, Don Carson, Professor Tora Tanaka and Mr. Fuji, Phil Hickerson and Dennis Condrey, Bob Roop, Bob Orton Jr., Dickie Steinborn, Kevin Sullivan, Jimmy Golden, Mr. Excitement, Dick Slater, Tony Charles, the Canadian Lumberjack, Joe LaDuc, Bob Armstrong, Crusher Blackwell, David Schultz, and more. Meanwhile, I move behind the mic to co-host the award-winning Southeastern Championship Wrestling TV program with Knoxville television personality Phil Rainey. The world champions of the day, Jack Briscoe, Terry Funk, and Harley Race, traveled to Knoxville to defend their titles against the best in the area and often escaped by the skin of their teeth. The early 80s saw an influx of great stars such as Blackjack Mulligan, Big John Studd, and more, and some newcomers making their mark in the ranks of professional wrestling. Tim Horner, Terry Taylor, Dirty White Boy Tony Anthony, Paul Orndorff, and a young gentleman by the name of Sterling Golden, who later became the legendary Hulk Hogan. The mid-80s were a period of change in Knoxville wrestling. Southeastern Championship Wrestling gave way to Continental Championship Wrestling, and Continental gave way to USA Wrestling, hosted by the legendary Gordon Solie. However, some of the faces remained the same.
Tennessee stud himself, Ron Fuller. And Ron,
pour down to the wine bottle, and I'm telling them I don't care what they have to do in there to beat a man. If they have to break their finger, if they have to break their arms, leg, back, or neck. Right around here, you can see right there. I done told my beloved stomper here on that program last week just to take the man in there, beat his brains out, and annihilate the man. Let him load him up and carry him out of here on stretcher.
From the late 80s till 1992, professional wrestling was all but dormant in Knoxville. Then Smoky Mountain Wrestling was formed to carry on the tradition of its predecessors. And on August the 5th, Smoky Mountain Wrestling will help you relive the glory years of professional wrestling with the Night of Legends, a celebration of the history of wrestling in Knoxville.
And now, everybody, this moment that we've all been waiting for, let's go to Les Thatcher and Phil Rainey. They're in the ring for the Knoxville Wrestling Hall of Fame Awards.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to officially introduce someone that I've worked very closely with over the last 20 years in professional wrestling, both on camera, behind the scenes, on the roads, in the planning stages. Ladies and gentlemen, the NWA Rookie of the Year, the 5 times co-holder of the Tennessee Tag Team Championship, 3 times co-holder of the Southeastern Tag Championship title, the producer and host of the award-winning Southeastern Championship Wrestling that got its inception back in the mid-1970s, may I present at this time the first inductee to the Pro Wrestling Hall of Fame, and it is my pleasure to introduce a good friend of mine and present him with his award, ladies and gentlemen, Les Thatcher.
You know, normally they hand me this thing, it's like giving a mass murderer a gun. But I have thought about this evening a long time, and there's so much to say, and yet I don't know what to say, except that I've wrestled in a lot of cities. I just celebrated my 34th anniversary in this business July the 4th. And every time I cross the state line coming down from my home in Cincinnati toward this town, I feel like I'm coming home because you people have made me feel a part of what goes on here. And I just like to say thank you very much for making my career such a great one. Thank you. And the next inductee, before I go to that, I want to take a moment to remember some people who were a big part of both the John Kazana promotion and the Southeastern Wrestling promotion who are no longer with us. And as I mentioned these four names, and then I would like a round of applause from them if you don't mind. Mr. Charlie Bauer, who worked in ticket sales. Mr. Ed Sandberg, who worked with the ring. Mr. Ed Hammond with security. And former broadcaster, Big Jim Hess. Please, a round of applause for those people. And the very second inductee is a man who I was able to teach a little bit about wrestling, and he was able to teach me a little bit, or a lot, I should say, about professionalism in broadcasting. You've seen him as a newscaster and a sportsman on all the major stations here in Knoxville. And he shared the microphone with me on one of the loves of my life, Southeastern Championship Wrestling through the 70s. Please, a big round of applause for Mr. Phil Rainey.
Thank you very much, Les. It's been a pleasure to be a part of Southeastern Championship Wrestling over the years. We've enjoyed a great association with the fans and also the men who work in the ring. We want to thank them for the many, many hours of enjoyment they've given me and given you, and I accept this award humbly. Thank you.
Thanks, Philip. If we could have our dignitaries are at ringside. All right. First, one gentleman who is not with us tonight. He had to work. The man who directed over 300 programs for Southeastern Championship Wrestling, a man who made Phil and I both look very good, and if you will, hold the applause till we're done here, Mr. Bill Kincaid, who couldn't be with us, but again, an intricate part of our operation. And now I'd like to introduce to you a good friend of mine for many years, a man who, along with his brother, held the NWA World Tag Team title on many occasions, and many of us feel was one of the top tag teams in professional wrestling history. He is also the general manager of Smoky Mountain Wrestling. Please, a big hello for Mr. Sandy Scott. Good. Yes, good to know you. And next, we would like to introduce to you another former wrestling great. He is a native of the great state of Tennessee, Mr. Billy Wicks. Hey, tough guy. And now, on the distaff side of our event this evening, this lady, a former wrestling champion and married to one of our inductees tonight, please say hello to Miss Sarah Lee. And now, one brief comment, and I know everybody's trying to rush me along, but a word about all the gentlemen that we're about to induct into the Knoxville Wrestling Hall of Fame. Wrestling has changed over the years in some ways, and in some ways it has stayed the same. But every one of these inductees have helped pave the way and open the doors for the young wrestlers of today. And each one of these men has everything, or a lot, one thing I should say, in common: a very strong, dedicated love for the sport of professional wrestling. And with that in mind, we will start our inductions. And coming up from ringside, first, he was a referee with Southeastern Championship Wrestling, making his home in Chattanooga, Tennessee. Please say hello to Tommy Weathers. A top NWA troubleshooter referee, chief of referees for many years, and a wrestling executive I had the pleasure of working with. Please say hello to Mr. Ronnie West. Our next inductee, Southeastern official and referee for tonight's Legends match, Mr. Mac McMurray. And next, former Southeastern wrestling promoter and a very, very close friend of mine, a man who I'm proud to make this presentation to, Mr. Bob Pope. Next, this man, a member of the championship Corsican Brothers team, say hello to a legend, Mr. Corsica Joe. Our next inductee, a former star in the Southeastern States and a former United States heavyweight wrestling champion, a very tough man, Mr. Dandy Jack Donovan. This next gentleman, a native of East Tennessee and a member of many top tag teams. He was the very first tag team partner of and teacher of the King Jerry Lawler. Say hello to Jim White. The next gentleman I'm going to introduce is accepting the award for his grandfather. This gentleman is the grandson of the former promoter and certainly a pioneer of professional wrestling here, the late John Kazana. Say hello to Joe Kazana. This next gentleman I have tangled with many, many times. One of the former Mighty Yankees championship tag team, a native of East Tennessee. You might know him by the name The Angel, Mr. Frank Morrell. Next is a lady whose husband was a manager of extraordinary talents and managed many championship teams, and at one time managed the Wright brothers right here in this part of the country. Say hello to Miss Jody Bass, wife of the late, great Sam Bass. And you saw this next gentleman earlier this evening when he helped the Rock and Roll Express regain their tag team titles. He was a former NWA Rookie of the Year and a Southeastern Heavyweight Champion, and a young man I've known since he was 13 years old when he took an old pair of wrestling boots that I was going to throw away, passed them up, and they were his first. Please say hello to my good friend, Ricky Gibson.
Ricky Gibson was a champion just a few months after his 1970 debut. His lightning speed and unique moves were ahead of his time. Seen here defending the Southern heavyweight title against Jerry Lawler in 1974, Ricky was a top prospect for world title honors throughout the 1970s. Unlucky breaks with injuries slowed his singles career, but he formed a championship team with brother Robert and held several tag titles before Robert formed the Rock and Roll Express with Ricky Morton.
Thirteen years old. Thank you there a lot, Les. I want to thank South Smoky Mountain for inviting me here for this nomination tonight. And also like to thank the fans that have came out. I had two missions when I came here tonight. One of them was to accept this award, and the other one was to see that the rock and roll got a fair shake, and I believe we did it. Thank you.
This next gentleman is certainly no stranger to Tennessee Vol fans. A football great, world powerlifting champion of 1980, five, six, and seven. And the world's strongest man, and it's certainly a star in anyone's eyes, Mr. Doug Furness.
It's a very humbling experience to be mentioned in the same breath with the rest of these great wrestlers. And I can only say thank you, Knoxville, for accepting me into professional wrestling. God bless you all.
Now, two gentlemen who were supposed to be out here with us and obviously have not shown up. Due to their feeling that they were cheated in their earlier match, Dick Slater and Bobby Orton Jr. have refused to come out and accept their award. And one further announcement before we go on to our last group of inductees. We also have a plaque here for a man who is at this time preparing to wrestle here later tonight, my longtime buddy, Bullet Bob Armstrong. How about a big hand for him? And if you will, watch the runway for our final inductees. This gentleman, my former tag team partner when we held the Southeastern Tag Team Championships, former Central States champion, Mid-Atlantic champion, and the former World Junior Heavyweight title holder. I used to wonder why you couldn't keep him on the mat. And then when I saw him ride a 2,000 plus pound bull out of a bucking chute, I knew why. Please say hello to a great, great wrestler, Mr. Nelson Royal.
Nelson spent a good part of his long career in the Knoxville area. Let's take a look at a part of a profile on Nelson that aired on Knoxville TV.
Nelson Royal won the NWA World Junior Heavyweight title in 1976. He successfully defended the belt until he retired in 1979. Nelson now wrestles steers instead of men, and we visited Royal at his ranch and western store in Mooresville, North Carolina, where the former champ talked about his career and retirement.
Man, you have more determination. I trained 7 days a week. I trained until it became a total nightmare. It's something that I hated to do. But then it all paid off. It paid off in Tulsa, Oklahoma, when I won the title. And making a transition from a world champion to a private citizen and running a business, it's a hard thing to do because you have to get your mind totally geared in another direction, because the pace that you've lived and the things that you've done, you don't want to give them up because you become accustomed to the fast lane. We have a bit. Would I do it over again? I'd do it in a New York second. I'd go back and start right at the beginning. I'd do everything. There's nothing I would really change. I don't think a man should even think about changing his life. I think you should be appreciative of what he's had and what he's got and continue to live the way he does.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, and all the children, I've got something to say. I'm really very fortunate to be in Tennessee. I still love the country, and I'm proud to be here today, and I want to thank all of you for ever making me what I am, because without you, I never would have. You're great people. Thank you.
Our next inductee, I would have to call probably the most feared wrestler in the history of Knoxville. I have felt this man's wrath. He is the former Southeastern Heavyweight Champion. Here he is, the Mongolian Stomper.
The Stomper made his debut in Knoxville in a two-ring battle royal on New Year's Day 1976, and the fans had never seen anything like this human wrecking machine. The Stomper tore through everyone in his path, men like Robert Fuller, Bob Armstrong, Jerry the King Lawler, Bob Roop, and more. And who can forget the famous TV incident where the Stomper hit the Canadian lumberjack Joe LaDuke in the head with a sledgehammer, hospitalizing him for a week. And how about this almost forgotten match from 1979 when the Stomper literally pulverized a young wrestling hopeful later known as Hulk Hogan.
I'd just like to say that I've wrestled all over the world, and there's no other city in the world that I'd rather accept this reward, Knoxville, Tennessee, because this is my home.
This next gentleman used my head, along with many, many others, for a battering ram on many occasions. You may remember him throwing the Southeastern title belt off the bridge. He's the former Southeastern champion, former Brass Knucks champion, and the former National Wrestling Alliance world champion. How about it for Ronnie Garvin?
No Night of Legends could be complete without the man they call the one-man gang, Ronnie Garvin. The Wild Canadian first appeared in East Tennessee as a partner to his brother, Terry Garvin, managed by their younger brother, Jim. But it was under the banner of Southeastern Championship Wrestling that Ronnie made his mark as a single and built his reputation as a wild man who would win at any cost to his body or the furniture in the Coliseum. Who can forget Ronnie's wild battles with Bob Orton Jr., Professor Boris Malenko, even the celebrated match against Andre the Giant, which saw the big Frenchman take the beating of his career? How about the time Garvin threw the Southeastern title belt off the Gay Street Bridge? But the greatest victory of Ronnie's career came in September 1987 when he defeated Ric Flair to become the National Wrestling Alliance World Heavyweight Champion.
Right in the top of the fence, Rick. Oh! Straddles the ropes and down. Garvin up. Look at him. Up on the top rope. Here he comes. Sunset flip. 2, 3. He did it. He did it. Ron Garvin. He did it. Ron Garvin has just won.
I don't know why, I got goosebumps. I'll tell you why, I'm gonna be brief, but this has always been my favorite city. I mean, I'm not saying that because I'm in Knoxville. I say that everywhere. If I could live here, I would. This has always been my favorite of every place I've been in the world. And I wanna say thank you, and thank you for your support, and God bless you.
These next two gentlemen cut a wide path through the United States in the late 50s and through the 60s. They were the original Heavenly Bodies, former holders of many tag team titles. One brother had that debonair, dapper look, and he could finesse you. The other one had a set of hams connected to his arms that would beat you like they were axes. Please say hello to a tough, tough tag combination, Don and Al Green.
Don and Al Green first came to Knoxville in the late 50s. And for the next 15 years, they held tag team titles all over the South. Southern tag team champions, Tennessee tag team champions. As a team, they were almost unbeatable. But they were both great single wrestlers as well. Big Al Green was noted for his size and power, which for the day were extraordinary. Al Green didn't wrestle, he fought. His big telephone pole broad arms and fists the size of canned hams knocked many top stars senseless. His biggest rival, in a feud which lasted for years and covered the entire state of Tennessee, was the fabulous Jackie Fargo. This match, from 1972 in Memphis, Tennessee, saw Green the winner and forced Fargo to shave his head in the ring. Don Green, as a single, won titles including the U.S. Junior Heavyweight title and also had the honor of appearing in the first scaffold match in wrestling history, taking on Jerry Jarrett in Louisville, Kentucky on August the 15th, 1971. This rare footage shows that Don Green was a man who would go to any lengths to settle a score. And of interest to Jim Cornette and today's fans, Don and Al Green were the first team to be known as the Heavenly Bodies.
As we come in early tonight, a kid come up and he said, "Boy, y'all are old." I said, "Yeah, I've seen a lot of people here that was kids when we started, and now they're grown, they got families of their own. We love Knoxville, and it's one thing." Another guy said, "Y'all are has-beens." Well, I'd rather been a has-been and never been at all. Thank you.
All right. When you talk about tag team wrestling, these two guys make my bad back ache, make me think of a lot of stitches in my head. I can't think how many times I've tangled with these guys, how many times they have held the Tennessee Tag Team Champions. For their years, they were what tag team wrestling was about in East Tennessee. And tonight, for the first time in 20 years, they are back together in Knoxville. Say hello to the Wright brothers, Ron and Don.
Ron and Don Wright were more than a tag team. They were an institution. The perennial Tennessee Tag Team Champions, they faced and defeated every team to come through the area for years. So well known were they that newspaper headlines simply called them by their first names. But as great a team as they were also top single stars. The brother who took most of the spotlight was the king of Kingsport, the number one hillbilly, Ron Wright. Ron Wright had a reputation with us wrestlers as one of the meanest men in the sport of wrestling. And with the fans, he had a reputation as probably the toughest man who ever lived. And it's universally accepted with the fans and the wrestlers alike that he was the most hated man in professional wrestling. Why? All you have to do is listen to this.
Back at ringside, you know, all kinds of wrestling action will be on the card Friday night at Chill Highway Park Arena. Tommy Gilbert asked for a match against Dandy Jack Donovan, who turned on Gilbert last night, left the ring after...
Turn that over and be quiet a minute. I've got a little something I want to tell you.
Oh, I don't doubt that.
How come you've got my chair run down slow? You've got it run down low trying to make...
I don't handle chairs, Ron. I don't have a thing in the world to do with it.
Put yours down there a little bit.
That's how
you're
little.
I want to tell you something. Let me tell you. I took that loudmouth, dumb old Dromo down there last night. I whooped that man to the point if they had to send 8 wrestlers and John Kazana and all the police in the building in there and hold me and pull me off of him. And that goes to show you what kind of man that he come out here and bragged that he was. What he...
You through?
No, I'm not through.
Well, have you wondered?
I was just sitting there waiting you to open that big mouth again so I can tell you to shut up. You come down here, all you know to do is sit down here and lie. I don't know why the people down here don't get up a petition and have you fired from down here. They ought to fire you and run you from off a TV hill. Hire me and take your place and give me your job.
Hey,
I do a 10-to-1 better job at it than you do.
It ain't me that got suspended.
Now, let me tell you something. These loud-mouthed idiot referees, they're low-down conniving. Don't stand there and tell me to wait a minute. I'll smack you from across the ring
go
over there.
Go ahead if you
just because they put a referee shirt on and hide behind them white and yellow and black stripes, they ought to be yellow stripes because yellow's all you are. Y'all ain't none of you nothing but a bunch of yellow-bellied nitwits.
Before you let your mouth run out, you put your hand...
Who can forget the feud between Ron and the late Whitey Caldwell, especially the brutal Tennessee chain matches? It lasted for years, ending only with Whitey's untimely death in a car wreck in 1972. Ron's wrestling career was filled with titles, blood, record crowds, and glory, and he fought as many fans as he did wrestlers. After Ron's wrestling career was over, he became a manager, with his biggest successes coming with the team of Phil Hickerson and Dennis Condrey, the Stomper and the Dirty White Boy. On August the 5th, Ron and Don Wright, the Wright brothers, will be together in the Knoxville Civic Coliseum for the first time in 20 years.
You don't know what an honor it is to be here to accept these awards. I'd like to say thanks for the years and years that I participated in wrestling, kept the fans happy. I'd like to thank my children, Terry Brown Wright, Sherry, Terry, my younger children, Josh Wright, David Wright, Charlie and Justin, and my wife, Teresa. You've really meant a lot to me, all of you standing behind me. And it's really nice to accept this award, and we thank you.
All right, now it is time to present the greatest wrestler in the history of Knoxville Award, as voted by the fans, sponsored by Spectrum Rents. It was very close. A lot of great wrestlers got a lot of votes. Even one of the gentlemen in the card tonight, Bob Armstrong, was very close. But I can tell you firsthand, this is the guy who beat you with his hands, brass knucks, chairs, and chains. He invented the Tennessee Chains match. One more time, let's bring back Ron Wright.
Well, I'll have to say this has got to be the greatest honor could ever be put on me, because let me tell you, I've seen some of the world's best wrestlers come through this part of the country, and you don't know what an honor it is to have you, the fans, to vote this honor up on me. And I thank you all from the bottom of my heart, and God bless you.
You stay right here, Ron. We have one more award. I'd love to make it, but he's going to. This guy meant a lot to both of us. Who's my partner and kicked his butt. But I'm going to turn the microphone over to Ron Wright to present an award about a man who personified courage and professional wrestling in this city. Ron?
Thank you, Les. Appreciate it. It is a real honor to present this award. This award goes to the late Whitey Caldwell, that died in an automobile accident. We're going to ask his wife and children if they will come out now and accept the award on behalf of the late Whitey Caldwell.
Whitey began wrestling in the mid-1950s at the Kingsport Boys Club, along with two other fellows named Ron and Don Wright, who would go on to achieve some fame themselves. The matches were held to raise money for the Boys Club. Admission was free, but concessions were sold. Promoter Mickey Barnes talked Whitey into turning pro, and he began a 16-year career that saw him become a hero to fans in Tennessee, Kentucky, Virginia, and the Carolinas. His most famous rivalry was a series of matches he wrestled against Ron Wright. Look at the main event of any card in the 60s or the early 70s, and Ron and Whitey were there. Whitey held the Tennessee tag title with almost a dozen different partners, including myself. But to the fans, Whitey stood head and shoulders above the rest. Who can forget the time that Whitey won Ron's prized Tennessee walking horse and then sold him at auction? Or the famous Tennessee chain matches? Unfortunately, there aren't many photos of Whitey around these days. He was too modest to allow them to be sold. Finally, when he did, one picture was sold at the matches, but the proceeds went to pay for a young girl's kidney operation. That was Whitey Caldwell for you, always thinking of others. In 1972, while still the Southeastern Wrestling Champion, Whitey was killed in an auto accident after a match in Morristown. His old rival, Ron Wright, took his place the following Friday night at Chilhowie Park, teaming with Dandy Jack Donovan to face Don and Al Green. The match, it sold out. The fans had come to pay one last tribute. In today's world, athletes and celebrities are only as popular as the latest fad. But devoted fans still make the journey to the Kingsport Cemetery, where Whitey Caldwell is buried, and put flowers on his grave 22 years after his death.
Nancy Caldwell, I'd like to present this award, electing your late husband, Whitey Caldwell, to the Hall of Fame and the Legends of Wrestling in Knoxville, Tennessee. I'd like to say one thing. I've never had as many beatings in my life that I've endured from the hands of Whitey. You don't know how it hurt me when the accident happened, but we'd like to present you with this award from the bottom of her heart, and I hope it means a whole lot to y'all. Thank you, and God bless you.
Thank you, Ron. I wish there was some way that I could let Whitey know what's going on tonight. He'd never believe it, and he'd never believe that you gave him a gold plaque. On behalf of all his fans, his family, thank you.
Thank you, Nancy, very much. And God bless you. Thank you, Les. It's been a pleasure. And God bless all of you, and you all have an enjoyable night.
Thank you, Ron. And one last time, how about a big Knoxville send-off for all our Hall of Fame inductees? Thank you.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, before we go back to action for the Thrill Seekers versus the Heavenly Bodies, let's take you back and see exactly how this match came about.
I'm sick and tired of Smoky Mountain Wrestling. The cameras following you everywhere, doing all the videos, how they follow you everywhere but in the toilet. Okay, that would be a horrifying sight. And I'm so sick of you saying how you love the fans. You love the fans. They're giving you presents. They're giving you presents. They're giving you things. They've never seen anybody that could count to five that had all their teeth in their face. That's the only thing they like about you guys. I'm sick of hearing about all that. The greatest tag team in the world was here at one time, the Heavenly Bodies. But because there's a crooked commissioner, because there's crooked referees, crooked politicians, crookedness all the way around in Smoky Mountain Wrestling, they're banned, okay? But believe me when I say this, I invented tag team wrestling. Me and the Midnight Express and the Heavenly Bodies. And I know a tag team when I see it, and you guys are a second-rate tag team. And if the Heavenly Bodies were allowed to be here, then they would have proved that. But you see, that, if you want to be honest and be truthful, that's why you're happy to be here. Because the Heavenly Bodies are here to show you up. That's why you're so happy. You get down on your knees every week and you thank the good Lord that the Heavenly Bodies are not allowed to be here, because then they would show you up. So what I want you to do is be honest and be truthful to the people. Tell the truth for once and admit that you know if the Bodies were here, you would be nothing. And all this stuff with the fans giving you cakes, that's gaga. And all the videos, that's gaga. Because you know you can't do the job in the ring. And I just wish you'd be honest with yourself. That's all I got to say.
You know, Mr. Cornette, you know, we are so happy that you came out here and showed us the error of our ways. I mean, you've really put us in our place, hasn't he, Lance? And I'll tell you something. You've shown us the error of our ways and the brilliance of yours, man. And to tell you the truth,
you know, I didn't give them this much credit.
You know, I'm so thrilled about you coming out here in our interview and telling us what we've been doing wrong, that I'm going to offer you a piece of our cake from the fine people of Loudoun. If you want a piece, just dig right in on Jimmy. And, you know, we appreciate everything you said to us. And we're really going to go home and think about this, aren't we, Lance? So go ahead.
Yeah, okay, they offer you a piece of cake.
If you insist, it does look pretty good. I'll go ahead and take a piece.
Oh, he got a piece of it, all right. Hey, Les, I believe this party's over.
Well, that's it. The party's over. And that's it for Smoky Mountain this week. Don't forget, tune in next week for news on Bullet Bob's mystery partner.
Kids, there's the referee. Go ahead, Gary. Go get his autograph.
Wow. Did you tell him thanks? Say, look, let's pose with him. He's going to pose with you. Get over there. Stand beside him, Ashley. There you go. Smile now. Smile. There you go. Look, kids, it's the Thrill Seekers. Go get their autographs. Hurry, kids, come here. Hurry. Ashley, Garrett, come here. Hurry. Come here. Oh, my God. Go get somebody to help. Get somebody to help.
Oh my God. What about that cake?
You know, Jim Cornette can say what he wants, but we all know it. Chris and I know it, and the Smoky Mountain wrestling fans know it. It was the Heavenly Bodies that beat us up in that parking lot, and thanks to that fans videotape, we've got proof. Jim Cornette even called the one Tom. We know it was the Heavenly Bodies, and so are all the fans. Chris took 18 stitches in the back of his head, and my face has looked better. But, you know, the Heavenly Bodies are really great, but we're not going to roll over and play dead for anybody.
That's right, you know, Heavenly Bodies, you were banned from Smoky Mountain Wrestling when you lost the Bluegrass Brawl at Rock and Roll Express. And now you want to come back into Smoky Mountain Wrestling. Well, you know, we could take this to court. We could file a grievance. But first of all, Jim Cornette would probably tie it up for weeks, months, years. Second of all, that's not how we want to decide this thing. You know, the only thing we could think to do legally to get you guys back in the ring is talk to Smoky Mountain Wrestling, who in turn talked to the World Wrestling Federation, who in turn told you that you had to come back to Smoky Mountain Wrestling for a week. And if a week is all we got, that's fine. Because there's two things in this world that don't forget. Elephants and thrill seekers. And we're not going to forget what you guys did to us, Heavenly Bodies. And I'll tell you something else, you made a mistake because you came and jumped us from behind. You beat us up. We're the first to admit you guys did a hell of a job. But let me tell you something. You didn't put us in the morgue. You didn't put us in the hospital. And therefore, you made a mistake because we're still alive and kicking. And believe me when I tell you that we might be flying all around. We might have new moves that you've never seen before, but we can fight. And we're here to say that coming up, we're going to take you guys and we're going to kick you like you've never been kicked before. Because we're not going to let you forget about this, because we're not going to forget about it. And none of the fans are going to forget about this either. So Jim Cornette and the Heavenly Bodies, you watch out, because we will have our revenge and it's going to be really sweet.
You know, it happens to every great labor organizer, every great union boss. Whenever you start getting a little power, the false accusations start happening to Jimmy Hoffa. Now I'm being accused of being responsible for things that I had nothing to do with. Sure, the thrill seekers got attacked in a parking lot. Hey, that's not my fault. It was two guys in masks that did it, but now they're claiming that I was responsible for it, that the Heavenly Bodies were the guys under the mask. And thanks to some snoopy old lady trying to get autographs for a little snot-nosed brat kid with a video camera, they got a tape of it. You know, it's that kind of snoopiness in America today that got those fine, upstanding Los Angeles police officers in hot water for trying to arrest that convicted felon Rodney King. But if you'll notice, on that tape, it clearly shows that I was the one trying to pull those guys off the thrill seekers. I was the one trying to call those guys back because I knew that Storm and Jericho couldn't sustain any worse of a beating than they were already taken. But no, they can't let it lie. You know, thrill seekers, there's an old saying, be careful what you ask for because you just might get it. They went to the promoters in Smoky Mountain Wrestling, all the officials. Smoky Mountain Wrestling came to the World Wrestling Federation. Two big corporations getting in some kind of hoo-ha, some kind of collusion against a labor union, just like always happens. And now the result is that the World Wrestling Federation has said that they're not going to sign any matches featuring the Heavenly Bodies for the period of August 5th to August 13th. They're going to force the Heavenly Bodies, under threat of a heavy fine, to go back to Smoky Mountain Wrestling to meet the thrill seekers anytime, any place, anywhere that they want. So the thrill seekers can get their revenge. They don't want to do it in a court of law because they haven't got any evidence. No, they want to get the Heavenly Bodies in a wrestling ring. Well, let me tell you something, punks, and I want you to listen real good. The Heavenly Bodies are coming back to Smoky Mountain Wrestling. The ban hasn't been lifted, but for one shining, glorious week, thrill seekers, the Heavenly Bodies, Dr. Desire, Tom Pritchard, and Gigolo Jimmy Del Rey, they're going to be back in Smoky Mountain Wrestling to teach you punks a lesson. Sure, you've had all the flashy videos. You got all the fancy Dan moves. You got those pretty faces, and all the fans are cheering for you. But now we're gonna find out if you got guts, thrill seekers. This is your acid test. This is your chance of a lifetime. Because these men dominated Smoky Mountain Wrestling on some very basic principles. Blood, guts, violence, and intimidation. And you've had some wins over some mid-level teams. You've done a few nice things. But when you get in the ring with the Heavenly Bodies, you're in there against the guys that have been there many times. You're in there against the cream of the crop. You're in there against a couple of guys that'll stop at nothing to end your career and send you on your way, because they ain't rolling over and playing dead for nobody. They got reputation to uphold. So, thrill seekers, we're going to find out if you've got it in here, brother, if you've got the heart and the desire to be on top, to be main eventers, to be championship material. Because the heavenly bodies are going to give you the damnedest fight that you ever been in your life. And I don't think you're going to win it. Thrill seekers, you asked for them, you got them. What are you going to do with them? The lights are down, but the thrill seekers have hit the ring from the backside of the auditorium. And we have got action and unscheduled. Look at there, the heavenly bodies flying over that top rope. And Chris and Lance, the thrill seekers, have launched the attack. And the heavenly bodies are, look at here.
Oh my, Lance Storm, right on the top. And they have really exploded here on the heavenly bodies. Jim Cornette is frantic to try to get the heavenly bodies back in the ring. It was the heavenly bodies and Cornette who not that long ago attacked the thrill seekers.
And you know, Cornette just said earlier, Jim, that the bodies were back and wanted to kick some tail, but they just got theirs kicked and rather soundly at the very opening moments of this bout.
Well, we must tell everyone that Chris Jericho has sustained a broken arm just less than 24 hours ago in a motorcycle accident. He refused to have it put into a plaster cast because if that would have happened, he would have been unable to wrestle here tonight. He did not want this opportunity to go by. He and his partner, Lance Storm, certainly wanted to get their revenge, and they have their opportunity right here, right now, tonight, at the Night of the Legends.
You and I have talked tonight about tenaciousness, stick-to-itiveness, and of course, young Chris exemplifies that.
Hard chops there by Dr. Tom Pritchard. Irish whip attempted but reverse into the corner. Nice elevation there by Chris Jericho. He's fighting basically with one arm. Look at the high elevation on Gigolo Jimmy Del Rey. Del Rey knocked down again by Jericho. And nothing has gone right thus far for the heavenly bodies and the master James E. Cornette.
I think at this moment, Doc and Jimmy would prefer to be any place but the Knoxville Civic Coliseum. Of course, is looking at that arm, that broken arm we're talking about, Jim, this means that all the high flying, the high risk maneuvers are limited to one Lance Storm tonight.
Well, you got to hand it to Chris Jericho for even competing here with a broken arm, went to the hospital. The doctors wanted to set the arm and to put it into a plaster cast, but that was not to be. He refused that medical treatment, so he's competing here at a great deal of pain, really paying the price to get his revenge, to get even, if you will, on the heavenly bodies. And it is Lance Storm now, and Gigolo Jimmy Del Rey, good switch there to the waist lock, and Gigolo Jimmy Del Rey now with the advantage. Great move there, and a kip up. High hip lock takeover, nice move there, and a straight martial arts kick, and another one, and down goes Dr. Tom Pritchard, and once again, the heavenly bodies have been foiled on the offensive attack.
And Jim Cornette is beside himself. This man is thoroughly upset. Nothing has gone right offensively for the bodies here tonight with these young men. And of course, you know, it's nothing to lose and everything to gain for Chris and Lance. They are actually virtually unknowns. They're fresh, new, young talent in this sport. And of course, their reputation, the prestige of the bodies, if they get a big win over them tonight, launches this young team onward and upward, Jim.
Absolutely, because the heavenly bodies, one of the great teams in the game, no doubt about it. Cornette's got quite some attire on tonight. Looks like he shopped at the late Liberace's garage sale or something. Dr. Tom Pritchard now, and Lance Storm in there. Pritchard with the takedown, to put the counter into the hammerlock by Lance Storm. This is by far the biggest match ever for this young team, this charismatic, exciting young team known as the Thrill Seekers. Overhand wrist lock applied by Dr. Tom Pritchard. Here comes the illegal double team. But look at the agility. A left arm, and he took them both down.
What a young man, and what maneuvers he has. He has countered or reversed and gotten out of everything these guys have thrown at him.
Now the double team again, being very, very effective here by the heavenly bodies. Going for that suplex. Look at the teamwork.
Oh,
and a pair of martial arts kicks. They kick in stereo
And the Heavenly Bodies are in a great deal of trouble.
Jimmy Del Rey looks like he's holding a handful of teeth as he crossed over our table here, very close to us. But you know, Phil Rainey just called my attention to the fact that Admiral Cornette is wearing the Vanderbilt University colors here tonight in Ball Country, Jim.
Well, I tell you, he looks like, again, like he stopped at the late Liberace's garage sale. That's a pretty good attire. He's got nothing on Elton John. Looks like he's off the cover of the Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club album. And if the Heavenly Bodies lose this, he will have a lonely heart.
Yes, he certainly will. Look at Del Rey go to work now, raking at the eyes and trying to counter this attack by the thrill seekers. And, another good reversal there, Jim.
Nice people. Inverted atomic drop. And another inverted atomic drop. And look at this young man, Lance Storm, really on fire here. And the quickness, the teamwork, the great teamwork of the Heavenly Bodies really coming to the front here.
The timing is phenomenal. The way Jericho came over the top at the exact right time there. These young men are phenomenal.
Yeah, this is, I had the opportunity to see them compete in the WWF. I've seen them here in Smoky Mountain Wrestling as Lance Storm thrown on the outside out here. And they are just as good as they come are Dr. Tom Pritchard and Gigolo Jimmy Del Rey. Obviously going into this match with a big edge and experience as Lance Storm being kicked and pummeled out here. I would have to say, with respect, that the Thrill Seekers are the decided underdog in this matchup, especially now that Chris Jericho has sustained the broken arm.
You're absolutely right. Of course, Jimmy Del Rey trying to slow down the one guy that's 100% on the Seekers team as he has him out there on that concrete floor stomping away at him. And of course, I think that's their key, the bodies. If they can stop Lance and then go after the injured Chris, Jim, I think maybe they can put it together.
Well, they have, good teamwork there. Great tandem maneuver there. There's a lateral press, 1, 2, and a half. Almost a victory there for the Heavenly Bodies, a near fall situation. And right now it looks as if they have isolated young Lance Storm far away from his corner. Waist lock into a suplex, great move. High impact move there by Gigolo Jimmy Del Rey. And he makes another tag with Dr. Tom Pritchard. And look at this teamwork. Great teamwork going.
Yes, they are going into that patented...
On the cover. Les, he's got him. This should be... Oh, no, it's not. It's not over. And Dr. Tom Pritchard thought he had it, but it was only a two count. And Cornette and company cannot believe it.
Lance is hanging tough as Pritchard and Del Rey cannot put him away. But we're seeing that great Heavenly Body teamwork now as they pound away, chipping away at young Lance Storm.
Great move up there. Lateral press, 1, 2, and 3. No, that's not three. It isn't three. It's a long two. Another near fall situation, and Lance Storm showing great intestinal fortitude to kick out there, but yet another tag has been made by the Heavenly Bodies. Well, Gigolo Jimmy Del Rey, you talk about high risk. He reinvented that term.
Whoa, Del Rey going high, coming down, and now he's going to gloat a little bit, Jim, as only the Heavenly Bodies can.
Well, I don't know if that's really necessary, but be that as it may, another stiff kick right to the head by Gigolo Jimmy Del Rey, and this young Lance Storm is being tested as he has never been before in his career. Straight martial arts kick. It found its mark. This should be all. This should be it right here. 1, 2, and he kicked out again.
Mark Curtis's hand is just inches away from that canvas on that three count for the second time, Jim.
Cornette looks like Earl Weaver there, the late Billy Martin, contesting the referee's decision.
Yes, he does.
And look at this teamwork here. You will not see a more finely tuned tag team than the Heavenly Bodies are tonight. 1, 2, and I can't believe that Lance Storm continues to take the punishment and continue to fight and compete here.
You know, I'm sitting here watching, and we've seen tonight the Rock and Roll Express, which has led the way for this kind of teamwork. We're seeing Del Rey and Pritchard, which are the epitome of it now, and that of the future, the Thrill Seekers.
You're absolutely correct. Absolutely. And that was a tremendous, tremendous vertical suplex. And now Dr. Tom Pritchard will take a chance. He's got his back to his opponent. Up on top, he went for the high-risk move, the elbow, and it did not pay off. Now maybe, just maybe, Lance Storm can make the tag. He's calling to the wrong corner. You got to know this kid is almost out of it. He needs to make the tag here. While Pritchard is down, can Lance Storm make the tag? Yes, he can.
And here comes Chris. He's got one hand, remember, broken. But watch this young man go to work. What determination.
He's wrestling with a broken arm, ladies and gentlemen. This young man wants revenge. What fighting heart we are seeing here with this tremendous young team. And a clothesline. Chris Jericho's clothesline found this mark on Dr. Tom Pritchard. He slammed him with one arm. That
good job.
Man, I'll tell you. I have seen a lot of great teams in my time. Oh, he was tipped on the outside. Dr. Tom Pritchard tipped this kid on the outside and takes him, oh my gosh, face first right into the steel security barricade. His face and skull just slapped and snapped off the steel. I'm not going to be surprised if this kid is not busted open here.
Look, he's going again with it.
Oh. And he's right in front of us. And this guy, you can see it. He's bleeding profusely.
He has split.
Oh, Cornette. The referee didn't see that. Cornette got him the racket. And Pritchard got him the right hand.
He is in trouble now, Jim. Serious trouble. They have got him lacerated bad.
He is bleeding and bleeding profusely. And now it will be perhaps just a matter of time until this young man with a broken arm and a lacerated head cannot continue anymore.
And you talk about a story. Look at what we've lost.
And this one is not for the weak at heart. I can tell you that.
Del Rey was ripping at that gut, trying to get it. And of course, the faster he loses that blood, the weaker he's going to get, Jim. And that's what they're counting on.
Absolutely, Les. Absolutely. Very good point. Gigolo Jimmy Del Rey. Well, what Jeff Cornette saying, he's going to know now what it's like to pay the price. We've got that picture. This kid is paying the price right here. And I don't know how much longer the referee should let this one go on, quite frankly. This kid can't defend himself, Les.
I'm going to tell you what, win or lose this one, I want to shake his hand tonight in that dressing room, Jim. This is quite a stirring moment for this young man.
They're just target practice, but look at him fight back. He's fighting back with all the heart and determination that any athlete in any sport could have.
Pritchard continually pounding away along with Del Rey, and yet he maintains his feet. Jericho is staying on his feet. I can't believe it.
He is so weak. He has lost so much blood here. That taped right hand of Dr. Tom Pritchard finding his mark, as you can see. This great camera work taking you right inside the ring.
Pritchard is tough.
Cornette's got a cheek shot.
Right.
Cornette should be ashamed of himself. What a dastardly attack by James E. Cornette on this helpless young Chris Jericho.
Jericho's face is a mask of blood at this point.
And he's a setting duck. He can't even keep his hands up to defend himself.
I'm curious how much longer this could go. He has lost a lot of blood here. Very much.
I don't think they care if they pin him or not. They want to hurt this kid. They want to end this kid's career. They want it to be all for the thrill seekers. It should be it. One, two, and he kicked out.
Oh my God.
He kicked out.
I wouldn't have believed it if I hadn't seen it. I thought it was over right there. And Cornette, look at him. He is fit to be tied.
The fists of the heavenly bodies are crimson from the blood of Chris Jericho. Hard knee drop right to the face. Once again, this is just horrible. Oh, my. This carnage must end. The referee's got to use some discretion here, Les.
I agree. I think the referee should stop it right at this point. I think if I were the official,
this should be right here. One, two. Pritchard can't believe it. I can't believe it. These fans can't believe it that this Chris Jericho just continues to fight and compete. He will not quit.
I've got to join the unbelieving, too. I cannot even imagine this young man is still on his feet. Yet.
Dr. Tom Pritchard just hammering away viciously and brutally on this kid who has been busted open, it looks like, from ear to ear. The referee checking him. Well, this is a big call for the official.
I cannot see what Mark Curtis is doing. He's got to put a stop to this thing. I think it's obvious to you and I both, they're only punishing the young man. They should have put him away.
Well, oh my, this is terrible. The heavenly bodies are trying to put this kid out of it for good.
They're giving him a beating that he will never, ever forget, and quite frankly, neither will I.
This is too much. Too much. There it is. They're stopping it right now.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Mark Curtis has stopped this match, saying that the Thrill Seekers can't continue. Once again, referee Mark Curtis has stopped this match.
I'm going to tell you what, Jim.
This kid doesn't want to quit.
No.
He's literally begging the referee not to do this.
They're going to restart the match.
They're going to restart the match.
I can't believe the courage. This kid's career could be on its last legs. The closing moments. He wants to restart it. Oh, wait. There's a martial arts kid. They got Gigolo Jimmy.
Oh,
they
my
want
God.
It. They want it.
Can you believe it?
The Thrill Seekers have defeated the Heavenly Bodies.
And your winner, ladies and gentlemen, the Thrill Seekers.
Virtually snatching it from the jaws of defeat, as they say, Jim. These young men, if on guts alone, they are the champions of the world.
I have never seen any athlete in any wrestling ring take the punishment and the pounding and lose the blood that Chris Jericho has here tonight and come back, and not only come back and continue, but win, and not only win, but defeat one of the greatest teams in the game in the Heavenly Body.
Look at that man. Look at him there, and he is the winner.
Hey, referee, how can you justify stopping the match, declaring us the winners, and then starting it again? How can you justify that?
Cornette, he never quit. I stopped the match because I thought he had enough. But he was a man enough to say he didn't have enough, he wanted more, and he still beat you.
In just a few short minutes, I'm fixing to walk that aisle. I'm going to walk that aisle in Knoxville, Tennessee, and probably in front of the biggest crowd ever to face Bam Bam Terry Gordy, one of the fabulous Freebirds for the Smoky Mountain Heavyweight title. Well, Bam Bam, I've went through hell and back again just to get this title, and you came in my backyard now. Are you man enough? Are you tough enough? I'm fixing to find out.
For another great championship event. We hope you are ready for this one. I have been looking forward to this one for quite some time. I've always admired the ability of Terry Bam Bam Gordy. I saw him, as you mentioned, last compete as a teenager. He's got nothing but better and better. He's just getting ready to get to the real prime of his career, and the Dirty White Boy has really come into his own in the last couple of years.
You're absolutely right, Jim. Of course, we might mention too that Bam Bam has been competing to the top of the championship ladder in Japan for quite a long time.
Wrestling for the All Japan Wrestling Promotion. One of their mainstays there for many, many years. Side headlock by the Dirty White Boy. Gordy followed him in, got knocked down the shoulder block.
In fact, was teaming with a guy who you are a very close friend of and fan of, Dr. Death, as a matter of fact.
Dr. Death, Steve Williams, a great pal of mine, and he and Gordy made a great tag team.
Yes!
Gordy has had a great deal of success in tag team wrestling, but let's not overlook his singular athletic ability. I think you would agree, Les, that this man is a candidate to win any championship that he sets his sight on.
Absolutely, and looking at the historical end of this, Tony Anthony, the Dirty White Boy, also was teamed with another gentleman, Len Denton, as a Dirty White Boy. So he has that team championship team background and has moved into the single spotlight. So both these men have the similar backgrounds. Tony spotting Bam Bam quite a few pounds. But again, I don't think we're going to be too worried about high-flying finesse here. It's going to be in the pits type of battle, in the trenches.
Absolutely, in the trenches indeed. Gordy with a 28-pound weight advantage over the Dirty White Boy. And 2 years of experience, the Dirty White Boy showing his tenacity, holding on to that side headlock.
And of course, Gordy is a methodical
type of wrestler. You won't see it, but you will see him open up with fiery spurts. He can move that weight around the ring with the agility of a man much lighter.
Again, the Dirty White Boy holding on to that headlock, and Gordy grabbed the hair and took the Dirty White Boy down. And Gordy not backing up an inch.
No, he certainly isn't.
It's almost like you would get into a barroom environment with two real tough guys, and you see them looking at each other, almost sensing that it's going to break loose at any moment between two big tough guys. Good side headlock takeover.
Absolutely.
And look, Gordy rolls him over into a pinning situation. Got a one count there.
You know, it's funny. White Boy has come out here trying to wrestle him.
Rolled him up again.
He's gone to that headlock, continually goes back to the headlock. And that's not normally his style. Maybe he senses something here with Bam Bam that we're not aware of.
I remember many years ago seeing a match in Springfield, Missouri, where Lou Thesz wrestled Danny Hodge.
Wow.
90 minutes, no falls, and Danny Hodge utilized a side headlock, and I'm not exaggerating, approximately 1 hour.
And you talk about two legends. Wow, Lou Thesz and Danny Hodge.
We're seeing a page out of that piece of history. As the Dirty White Boy wants to keep it very, very basic here. Certainly doesn't want to make any mistakes. As a matter of fact, Les, he can't afford to make any mistakes against a man as great as Terry Bam Bam Gordy.
That's right. One small mistake and Bam Bam will capitalize it. There's no two ways about it.
Well, right now, Gordy may be playing some mind games on a very volatile Dirty White Boy. Pulling that hair, and the short fuse of the Dirty White Boy is certainly evident. He can't get out of his game plan. He can't get too emotional. And it's hard to stay unemotional in such an emotional situation.
You're right. And Gordy seems to be staying emotionless, as you mentioned. He seems to show no expression.
Rolls him over. Got a two count.
And I've got to think that he's doing that to try to psych Tony out of his offense. Because I think he's trying to make the champion believe that he has no concern about him at all, which could really affect it.
Another near fall there, pending predicament. Anthony out really in a great deal of trouble. If he can always relinquish the hold and come off his shoulders there in that particular predicament.
Yeah, I'm curious of his strategy here, too. I think with a man of this size and the power of Gordy, you need to be taking one of those limbs out, one of those 4 points of the other 4 points of balance. I don't think the headlock is going to put the man away, but of course, this is Tony's strategy, and I'm sure he knows where he's going with it. He's a veteran.
Well, there's so much footage that the Dirty White Boy can study on Terry Bam Bam Gordy in single competition and tag team competition. I'm sure he's got a very sound scouting report. A lot of documentation that he can research on Terry Bam Bam Gordy's magnificent career. And again, Gordy goes to the hair. And Gordy caught him coming in with the right hand. That may be exactly what he was waiting on. Gordy with a kick to the head.
And Gordy opening up for the first time now, Jim. Really actually trying to go to work on this guy.
Gordy picking him up. Slams him. Relatively easy. And tries the fist right down into the face of the Dirty White Boy, does Terry Bam Bam Gordy.
And as I mentioned earlier, look how methodical he really is. Just going about it in a set pace, but doing the damage nonetheless.
Well, Hayes and Roberts were a great compliment to this big bruiser. He was always the killer of that trio. Irish whip in, and he caught him coming out with a clothesline. And there's nowhere to go for Tony Anthony but down on that bottom turnbuckle. And Gordy come in. That's a mark of a veteran. Caught him coming in. Caught him with a knee right in the face.
Exactly. Exactly. Stand right on.
Oh!
And again, as you mentioned, following him in close. No way for Anthony to come out of there or to retaliate.
Gordy, that big guy. Looks like about a size 14 or so. Dumping on the chest, trying to drive the oxygen right out of the lungs of the Dirty White Boy. And the Smoky Mountain heavyweight champion in a great deal of trouble. His title in jeopardy here.
Exactly. And, you know, talking about great wrestlers, he beat a man that was very tough, international star Jake the Snake Roberts, to regain this title.
Gordy tried to get him up with a suplex, and the Dirty White Boy blocked it. And what a test of strength here, a real gut check for both these athletes as Gordy used that weight advantage. We said it was 28 pounds to force the Dirty White Boy back into the corner. And a hard right hand follows it with the elbow, and the Dirty White Boy in a lot of trouble.
Of course, you might point out here, too, as physically taxed as the White Boy is, that 28 pounds is more like 128 pounds if you're trying to lift that man up. And as you can see with that great camera shot there, he is blowing hard. Gordy is wearing him down.
Gordy's face I've looked at almost emotionless. It's almost as if he's focused just on one thing. And right there, the Dirty White Boy made a nice counter move to prevent from going into the turnbuckle and sent Gordy there himself.
But Tony unable to follow it up. That's the key, I think, Jim. He's going to put the big man away. He's got to stay right on him.
Gordy, make it three times to that top turn. Look at his face. His staring at the Dirty White Boy as if he's not even fazed or bothered even.
It's almost as if he's in a trance, would you say?
Yes, I think that would be a good description of Terry Gordy here. He's very, very focused. He knows exactly what he wants. He wants the Smoky Mountain Wrestling Heavyweight title.
Anthony trying to regain some composure out there, and of course he's got that 20 count. I would suggest taking every bit of it.
Fans from all over North America here watching this event. The Knoxville Civic Coliseum jammed to the rafters here. Gordy snapped the Dirty White Boy's neck right off that cable.
We might mention, too, if you're just joining us, this is the Night of Legends at the Knoxville Civic Coliseum and a record crowd for Smoky Mountain Wrestling here. Gordy just doesn't seem to be in any hurry, Jim, and I can't envision what is on his mind at this point in time.
Well, this match with a one-hour time limit, he's got plenty of time. Not in any hurry, as you mentioned. No wasted motion by the challenger for the Smoky Mountain title.
Maybe I'm mistaking it for something it's not, but could it be that he is that confident of putting the white boy away that he sees no need to rush this thing, that he is in the driver's seat?
Well, perhaps. They make a very valid point. I think he certainly doesn't want to make any mistakes here against this very volatile champion, and a good counter move there by the Dirty White Boy. And now let's see if he can get back on the attack here and regain some momentum. He's taken quite a pounding from the challenger thus far. Oh, right hand, and another right hand, snapping Gordy's head back. The White Boy getting some momentum from the rope and puts down the challenger with a hard, hard right hand to the jaw.
And the champion is opening up now, and wow! Oh.
Gordy saw that one coming, caught him walking in. He's got him cradled. Hey, his feet are on the ropes. His feet are on the ropes. The referee couldn't see it. He was blocked out, and Terry Bam Bam Gordy about a count away from winning the Smoky Mountain Wrestling Heavyweight title any way that he can.
That elbow, and again the elbow. Again, it's that methodical way of moving that he's got, almost like a machine.
Gordy trying to follow him in again. This time the Dirty White Boy moved out of the way. It's a slugfest now. And another big time right hand by the Smoky Mountain champion puts him down.
Whoa! Down goes Mark Curtis.
Referee cracked heads there, and the referee is down, and now both men just trying to, they're just fighting away. Now choking each other in the corner. Referee Mark Curtis is down. And this is a very precarious, wait a minute. There's Chris Walker, opponent Chris Walker with a double axe handle from behind. And now Walker and Gordy double teaming the Smoky Mountain champion. Walker holding the champion.
Mark Curtis calling an end to it here, Jim.
Tony and Chris Walker stomping away. He really doing a number on the Dirty White Boy.
And here comes the troops, the R&R Express.
Rock and Roll Express, Gordy.
Ladies and gentlemen, Bam Bam Terry Gordy has been disqualified. Outside interference. The winner of the match, the Dirty White Boy, and still the Smoky Mountain Heavyweight Champion.
Well, I'll guarantee you there'll be a score to settle when Tony Anthony, the Dirty White Boy, gets his hands on Conan Chris Walker.
Tonight's main event pits a team captained by Bob Armstrong against a team managed by Jim Cornette. The hatred between Cornette and Armstrong goes back to the first days of Smoky Mountain Wrestling and was deepened when Bob served as special referee in the tag title bout at the first Fire on the Mountain event in August 1992.
Armstrong is a two count on Stan Lee.
Jim Cornette threw powder or something in the eyes of Jackie Fulton.
Richard goes to roll him up. He gets him. It's a two count. And I can smell the talc over here. He must have been to the barber supply. Armstrong talking to Cornette. Said he...
He's throwing Cornette out.
Cornette is out of here away from ringside.
Commissioner Bob Armstrong is ruled that Jim Cornette must leave.
Looks like a baseball game. The umpire threw him out again.
Out of here, yes. Obviously, Bob spilled the powder as well, and he's sending Cornette. He's informed us Cornette is no longer in this one. They've got the headgear off of Stan Lane, so he is now susceptible to lacerations as well.
He just went into the barbed wire.
We have got a Donnybrook of major proportions on our hands, Phillip.
Stan Lane draped across the barbed wire. Right there is Jackie Fulton. It works on Stan Lane.
And I think at this point, the only man who is not bleeding in that ring is the referee, Commissioner Bob Armstrong. Lane has indeed been opened up, and how else could it happen? You hit that barbed wire once, twice. There's no way to miss the barb sticking out of that.
And wrestling fans, Jim Cornette has been taken out of the auditorium. He is not ringside.
Trying to double suplex the heavenly bodies, but saved by younger brother Jackie. Bobby gets a two count on Stan Lane. And this one has gotten, oh-ho! Check it out. Pritchard trying for the pin. And a save by older brother Bobby. Russian leg sweep by Stan Lane on Bobby Fulton. Both Pritchard and young Jackie trying for a suplex. Neither man up. Dr. Tom with the drop. And Phil, it's hard to keep pace here of who may be ahead in this one, and it's going back and forth as fast as we can come.
Here's Tom Pritchard, top strand ropes, misses as Jackie rolls away.
Bobby Fulton has the headgear now that was protecting Stan Lane and hammering him with it, taking him into that barbed wire again. Cornette is back. Cornette is back. The racket goes to Tommy Pritchard. Pritchard is taken away by Commissioner Bob Armstrong. Two and three. And with
time
assist,
of the fall, Commissioner Bob minutes, Armstrong, 18 seconds
you've got
winners.
New
and
out,
new
and Cornette comes over here. He can't believe his team lost the title.
Jim Cornette is beside himself.
The pressure built until finally, in May 1993, Bullet Bob again signed a referee match involving Cornette's men. Just before that match, the two had a heated confrontation.
Big roundhouse right hand, high to the top of the head, and another one, and down goes Lane. Rolling now, beginning to work on those legs. That spinning toe hold, he may be going to get him in that figure four. He's got him locked in it. Here comes Pritchard up. Look at this. Chuck Mantell runs over quickly to grab Pritchard to keep him out of the ring. And the referee goes down, hit hard from behind by Stan Lane. And the referee's down. Golden now has got Lane covered. There's no referee. Here's Cornette in. And Golden quickly out of the way. Now again, he's got Lane covered. Here comes Bob Armstrong in. One, two, three. He must be getting some practice for tonight.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of the match, Jimmy.
Let me just say something, Bob Armstrong. You see, I'm very near having a stroke. You see, I got a lot of problems going on in my life right now. And I know all these people would love to see me drop over and pop arteries out of my neck. And I know that you would love to be the cause of it. But let me tell you something, Bob Armstrong. You've gone way too dead-gum far right now. Ever since day one, you have been against Jim Cornette. You've been against the heavenly bodies. You've been against everything I've tried to do, and you have done your dead level best to run me out of Smoky Mountain Wrestling. And that's okay, because I've done the same to try to get you unseated as commissioner. And I don't care whether every single one of these stinking coupon clipping food stamp eating rednecks thinks that you're the greatest thing since sliced bread or not. I got a different story to tell. Bob Armstrong, you're nothing but a stinking, crooked politician. That's all you've ever been, a stinking, crooked wrestler at one time. And then, since you're so stinking old that you're retired now, you're a stinking, crooked politician. And I personally am ashamed that Smoky Mountain Wrestling has a stinking old redneck like you running it. But let me tell you this, you know, I sit here and I get all upset, and I'm about ready to pass out. But you know, I ought to be laughing. I ought to be happy. Because you see, everybody knows that I'm successful. Everybody knows the heavenly bodies are the greatest thing in the world. And everybody knows that regardless of the rage of the cage or the last tangle in Tennessee, we're gonna remain that way. But you know something, Bob Armstrong? Everybody's ashamed of you. Not only these fans, not only everybody at Smoky Mountain Wrestling, your whole stinking family's ashamed of you. You want to know, hey, Dixie Dynamite, that goof running around here with a sock on his face, you know who that is? That's Scott Armstrong. I'll say it right now. That's his stinking son. That's Bob Armstrong's son, Scott Armstrong, who is so ashamed of his old man that he has to wear a mask over his face. He's ashamed to be a member of the Armstrong family. He's ashamed to be associated with a crook like Bob Armstrong, so he wears a mask over his face like a common stinking criminal. That's what Dixie Dynamite is. He's Scott's to hate.
Here is Dynamite.
Let me tell you something, brother. I ain't ashamed of nothing. I am Scott Armstrong. I don't owe you nothing. I don't owe nobody nothing. Let me tell you something, and I want everybody else to know it too. I'm not ashamed of my father. I love my father with all of my heart. He is the most honest man I have ever met. And I'll tell you something else too. He raised me and my brothers to be good-hearted men. Whether I wear a sock on my head, the reason I wore a sock on my head is so that whining mama's boys like you didn't run their mouth to the promotion, Sandy Scott, saying that he's daddy's boy, so let's show him a little favoritism. Brother, I didn't want the favoritism, so I wore the mask because I love my father.
Well, there's your answer.
Yeah, that's a great sentiment, Scott Armstrong, but let me tell you one thing, I don't love your father. Hey, because he's been against me and mine ever since day one. You come out here and you say, I love my daddy, that's why I'm going to wear a sock on my face. Well, I got news for you. I think you're still ashamed. And I'm, hey.
Commissioner Armstrong.
Listen, if you got something to say to somebody, don't be talking about my family. Don't be talking to these fans. Have a little guts. Say it to my face. If you got something to say, say it. For God's sake, just say it to me.
That's exactly what I'll do with it. I'll say it to your Ernest T. Bass-looking face with that cap on. I'll say it to you. You are without a doubt the lowest form of human life that I've ever known in my life. You say you're the commissioner, and you push a pencil, and you tell people where to go, and you tell people what to do, and you make all these rules, and you've been trying to screw me since day one. But it ain't worked, and it ain't gonna work, and no matter what you do, it is not gonna work. You know what you're like? You know what you're like, huh? You know what you're like, big man, big barrel chest? You're like a drill sergeant hiding behind his stripes. You're like a police officer hiding behind his badge. You got that commissioner's tie on, and as long as you wear that commissioner's tie, Mr. Commissioner, can't nothing happen to you. Can't nobody punch you in the face. That's what you're hiding behind, is that commissioner's tie.
Hey. If this tie is bothering you, let me solve your problem. It's just a clip-on tie. It comes right off, the shirt comes open, the tie goes down, and it's very simple. It's very simple. The tie's off now. If you got something else to say, let's hear it.
I'm saying to you, Armstrong, you've gone too stinking far. You have tried to best me for the last time. You're not only the only one involved in this, but your family is too. Brad down there in Atlanta, Steve sitting home wherever he is, Peanut Head over there, and it's Brian, the little one, the one that went off and joined the Marine Corps and became known as the world's biggest deserter for hiding out.
Whoa, wait a minute. And Armstrong has got him.
If you ever say anything about my family again, brother, I'm gonna knock you out.
You can't talk to me like that.
Oh, and he does, and down goes Cornette. as the commissioner slugged him, and Cornette hits the floor, and he hits it hard, fans.
Things turn violent in this very arena at the rage in the cage at the Volunteer Slam, resulting in the most vicious beating Armstrong had ever suffered.
On Robert Gibson, they got one of the guys, reached out and kicked him in that leg, and off his feet he went. He went down.
I tell you what, if one of those guys can get to that leg and get to it severely enough, he'll be out of it.
Oh, look, they got Pritchard.
And they got the leg. Morton's got the figure four. He's got it.
It has to be a submission, their only hope.
Bring
That's going to be
He's
it.
He's giving up.
Can you believe it?
In a 360-degree turnaround, it was almost over for the Rock and Roll Express, and they had fortunes leading their way.
Well, I'll tell you what, I have never been happier to have egg on my face less than I am here.
I hear you.
I had counted them totally out. Morton, I had useless. Only primetime Brian Lee that was physically able, and they come back and not only pin three of them, handcuffed three of them, but ended up getting a submission on Stan Lane, and here is a victory the Rock and Roll Express will love forever.
And wouldn't you know it, the two guys who were injured the worst were the two left in the middle of the ring and ended up being the
Ricky Martin was the first
absolutely.
Man in, right?
Absolutely.
23 minutes, 46 seconds of wild. Oh, Jimmy Cornette just nailed Bob Armstrong. He hit him with that racket. You could hear it all the way to Chattanooga from Knoxville. Uh-oh. Now Pritchard. Look at Bob's ready.
Bullet Bob. They said he can't go. Watch him go now. He's got the heavenly bodies in Cornette, and he's having his way with them. Cornette hit him with that tennis racket, and he might as well have hit a bull elephant.
All it did was get him to turn around.
You don't know what you've done, Jimmy Cornette. Look at here. Reversed it, and Pritchard was caught by his own partner. Oh. Sullivan's free, and Armstrong is in trouble. And look at here, there goes
Golden
the stud
stable. And Fuller leave and they walk out.
So, Gibson, Lee, and Morton are still in that ring. And Morton has been hooked by the handcuff over here. Look over here, Stan Lane has hooked Morton in that handcuff.
On the opposite side of the ring,
Bob
Ricky
Armstrong
is
being pummeled by the entire team of Jim Cornette.
You get so mad, Cornette, you just absolutely.
Just Mark Curtis trying to climb.
Cornette again, just lambasting him. And now again and again.
He's been choked down and pounded down. Bob's not moving now.
I don't know who in the world there is to help, but they have got to get somebody in there to help Bob Armstrong.
Sullivan going back to work on Ricky Morton.
Pritchard now teeing off on Bullet Bob. Ricky Morton slumps to the canvas.
Sullivan using that chain across the throat.
Gibson and Brian Lee still handcuffed to the side. Golden and Fuller walked out of the fight.
Morton
Ricky
out.
Is absolutely useless, and I mean that only in the sense that he is out, just exactly
like
Glenn
said. They're going to handcuff.
Brother, I'll tell you one thing, Cornette. Look at that. He clears him away, so he'll have a free shot at him. Here comes Tracy Smothers. They got the door.
Tim Horner's down there with him. Smothers and Horner are at ringside. Sullivan swinging that handcuff on the long chain at both Smothers and Horner. Oh, look at Cornette with Armstrong. Look at him.
Oh, yeah.
Look at
him. Big man. Got him both arms handcuffed to the cage. And Cornette slapping him. Got his tennis racket. Oh. Teed off both hands right in the midsection.
That rib cage has taken a hell of a battery. Excuse my language.
Honestly, Les. This is this is as bad as anything I've seen. Tracy and Tim Horner frantic to try to get in there.
Look right above us there. The referee, Mark Curtis, trying to climb up and over. Kyle keeping him out. Now Sullivan going to work on Brian Lee. And Cornette and company are having a picnic in that ring.
Keep Cornette!
Boy, that's the kind of stuff, I'll tell you what. I'd like to see worse than that happen to him, but this guy's license ought to be jerked.
I will say this. Cornette better hope that Bob Armstrong stays chained to that fence, whether it's today or 10 years from today, he will pay, and pay dearly.
Cornette teed off on Gibson and Lee and Morton and back over to Armstrong. And I think I got an idea what you're saying, Les.
A cracked sternum, broken ribs, internal bleeding. Armstrong was hospitalized for a week and out of action for eight more. But he resigned his commissionership and returned to the ring in August 1993 to make good on his promise. Send Jim Cornette to the same hospital Cornette had sent him to.
Cornette with a foot to the forehead of Bullet Bob Armstrong. This is a lumberjack match with wrestlers stationed around the ring, but Armstrong's army has tennis rackets. Cornette still using the karate chops to the throat of Bob Armstrong. Now goes to work on the back of Armstrong. Chokehold rakes his head across the top strand of ropes, catapults him off, and Cornette all of a sudden has things going his way in this match. And you can give Jimmy Del Rey credit for that, and Tom Pritchard with the powder. But Bob Armstrong says he's going to send Cornette to the hospital. Now, wait a minute, Cornette. I don't think that was a smart move. Tennis racket into the ring. Oh, my goodness, did you hear that? Cornette got a help from the outside and a tennis racket into the back of Bob Armstrong, and the racket taken away by the Boss Man. Now, boy, I could feel that one way up here. From left field, that one came. Cornette shot across the ring, and he gets a chop to the throat. Cornette bailing out, trying to get on the outside. Bob Armstrong goes after him, rams his shoulder into that turnbuckle. Now, that was the shoulder he was crying about earlier. And we've got mayhem on the ring down below on the outside of the apron. Tennis rackets. Cornette crawled under the ring. He has gotten out of harm's way right there. Smart move by Cornette. Well, let's see where he comes out. Yeah, there he is. He's being held by, well, he's cut by Ricky Morton, put back in the ring. Armstrong trying to get back in. Now he does. Cornette has a laceration on his forehead. He appears to be dazed, and he's swinging at the corner. Nobody there. Oh, tap him on the shoulder. Now, here it comes. Yeah. Bob Armstrong going to work now on Jim Cornette. Cornette has a laceration on the head. And Bullet Bob's going to help it along a little bit there. Cornette is dazed, doesn't appear to know where he is. And Bullet Bob going to work on Cornette.
This is not a position I would want to be in if I was Jim Cornette. As we pointed out, Cornette is not a wrestler, but he has managed some good teams. And there's the atomic drop. That ought to take care of Cornette's head for a while. One, okay. Does he want to do it again? Big Boss Man doesn't object to it. He's going to pick him up and go one more time. Well, he dropped him again. After being on the offense for quite a while, Cornette has felt the brunt of the Armstrong anger, and he is out on the canvas. And we have a three count for Bullet Bob and the winner, Bob Armstrong. Cornette yet to get up after being dropped twice on the head by Bullet Bob.
9-1-1.
Bullet Bob said he would do it. Now the Armstrongs pick up the chant of 9-1-1. 9-1-1.
Cornette wouldn't give up. From his hospital bed, he obtained the services of Terry Funk, who came to Knoxville in September 1993 to battle Bullet Bob with a commissionership on the line.
Armstrong turns him around like a top. Now puts his head into the turnbuckle. Goes for the sleeper. Armstrong is applying the sleeper in this match. Can he hold on to it? Can Armstrong hold on to that sleeper? Funk is down on, he was on one knee. Now he's sitting up. Here comes Dr. Tom Pritchard. Bob Armstrong broke the sleeper hold. Scott Armstrong and Tom Pritchard going at it outside, and Armstrong going to take care of business with Terry Funk. And he sends Funk down. Little red on Funk's forehead. Two count. Funk raised up. Tom Pritchard. And look here. Here comes one of the Bruise Brothers. Armstrong's going to take care of him. Bruise Brothers. Here comes. Oh, Ricky Morton's in the action now. Ricky Morton and one of the Bruise Brothers, Scott Armstrong and Dr. Tom Pritchard. But in the ring, we've got Terry Funk and Bob Armstrong. And all heck is broken out here in the Knoxville Coliseum as Terry Funk taking plenty of punishment. There goes Dr. Tom Pritchard's head into the ring post. And Funk is down on his back. Bob Armstrong goes for the cover, too. Uh-oh, here's Jim Cornette interfering. Jimmy Del Rey and Brian Armstrong into it now. We've got the Armstrongs involved with the Heavenly Bodies and Terry Funk and Bob Armstrong inside the ring. And across the way, one of the Bruise Brothers and Ricky Morton. Well, we're bound to see it. Here comes the Bruise Brothers number two, and Bob Armstrong catches him. Meanwhile, Terry Funk is getting on his feet as Scott Armstrong and Dr. Tom Pritchard battle on the floor. Terry Funk missed Bob Armstrong and caught one of the Bruise Brothers. And once again, Terry Funk is on his back. Brian and Jimmy Del Rey, Scott Pritchard, and Scott Armstrong going at it. And across the way, the Steiners are double teaming. Cornette got the boot and missed Bob Armstrong and caught Terry Funk. Now Bob Armstrong has the collar, the neck protector, and jerks it off of Jim Cornette. Bob Armstrong going right back to work on Cornette, but he's got away. Here comes that branding iron. Looky here. And he catches Bob Armstrong on the back of the neck with that branding iron and drops it outside and rolls over on Bob Armstrong as the referee counts 1, 2. Did we get a three count? The winner, Terry Funk, it looks like. Let's see. Terry Funk was helped out.
Therefore, Jim Cornette is the new commissioner.
Due to Cornette's chicanery, Armstrong was barred from Smoky Mountain Wrestling. But the masked bullet appeared and went through all of Cornette's henchmen, Kevin Sullivan, Dick Murdoch, Killer Kyle, until February 1994, he got his rematch with Funk at Sunday Bloody Sunday. If Funk won, Bullet would leave forever. If Bullet won, Bob Armstrong would once again be commissioner.
Terry, what are you doing? Oh! Trying to do a moonsault on the Bullet. I have to question the sanity of that move myself. Okay, all right. Terry Funk's first fall. Both men look like they're down right now. Announcer, do we have an announcement? No announcement as of yet, but the referee counted three.
10 seconds in the rest period.
10 seconds in the rest period. Both men down. Funk made a very, very, I think, unwise move when he came off the top. 20 seconds in the rest period. Both men down. Both men down. Okay, both men, referee counting, both men trying to make it to their feet, and it looks like both men are stunned right now. I can't quite see the count. Both men coming to their feet, referee Mark Curtin. Now both men to their feet. I think he was at the eight mark or the nine mark. Now we're going for, he went for a pile driver. The Bullet reversed him, sending flying over the top, right into that stack of chairs that the Funkmaster put there a few seconds ago, and now DDT'd into his own pile of chairs. If you tuned in late, this match right here, falls don't count. And if one, two, another fall for the Bullet. Another fall for the Bullet.
The winner of the fall and the pinned Bullet.
Both men still down. We can see the wear and tear on both men right now.
10 seconds.
10 seconds gone, the rest period. Both men down just like they were the fall previously to this.
20 seconds in the rest period.
So let's even it up now. It looks like the Bullet, three falls to one, but that doesn't really mean anything. I'm just keeping score for you fans at home. This match conceivably, like I said, go 20 falls, 25 falls, 30 falls. I remember a match I had one time, I went 86 falls. 86 falls, you believe that? 86 falls. I'm talking to my cameraman right here. Terry Funk, Jim Cornette telling Terry Funk, former NWA World Champion, to come to his feet. Wait a minute, he didn't make it. And we got our new commissioner of Smoky Mountain Wrestling. Bob Armstrong will resume the commissionership of Smoky Mountain Wrestling.
The match is the Bullet.
With a victory here over Terry Funk. Terry Funk down in the corner. The Bullet pressing the attack. Cornette in on a shot by that big tennis racket. And that drops the Bullet. The Bullet down. Now Cornette clearing out those chairs. Another visitor in the ring now. There's Dory Funk, brother of Terry. But we got a new commissioner, but I don't know if he's going to be able to resume it. It looks like Funk trying to brand or trying to drive that cane through the Bullet's back. And another shot by Cornette. Last year about this time, people, Cornette hit Bob Armstrong 30 some odd times that tennis racket, put him in the hospital, broke his sternum several weeks before he could even walk. But right now, the Bullet paying the price, even though Bob Armstrong is the new commissioner. Dory Funk now making his first appearance in Smoky Mountain Wrestling, and Terry doing a number on the Bullet. The winner here, of course, the Bullet, because Terry Funk did not quite answer the bell. They got him hooked in.
He's gonna kiss my feet! Wait a minute, boys!
Jim Cornette saying that the bullet is going to kiss his feet, which was a stipulation.
Let's give him the opportunity to do it on his own. I want you, Armstrong, to crawl over here and kiss my feet.
Cornette.
Come on, boy. Kiss him.
Jim Cornette saying that the bullet is going to kiss his feet regardless.
He's slapping him now. The cheer is going up. I can't see what's going on. We got company, and it looks like Anthony Michaels, Tracy Smothers, coming into the ring, of course, saving the bullet, the humiliation.
Armstrong, once again commissioner, was unable to wrestle while holding that post due to the conflict of interest rules. But in May 1994, Bullet Bob brought Macho Man Randy Savage to Knoxville to eliminate Cornette's newest monster, Bruiser Bedlam.
Cornette trying to stop him. At a point, Armstrong comes over, nails Cornette. And down goes Cornette. Savage with the jump and the elbow. He's got him for the pin. One, two, three. Savage counts him himself. Referee Mark Curtis trying to stop Armstrong and Cornette. Savage has him pinned. Savage could have had a 12 or a 15 count at this point. And Armstrong slamming away at Jim Cornette. Into the picture comes Dory Funk. What's going to happen here? Funk misses the shot. Arms catches him. Watch Savage and Bedlam in the ring. Savage catches Bedlam with an elbow in the ring while Funk and Armstrong go at it out on the floor. Cornette, what's Cornette doing? What's Cornette doing? Cornette throwing powder into the eyes of Bob Armstrong. Savage trying for the body slam, can't quite get him up. He gets him on the second attempt, down he goes. Mark Curtis checking the eyes of Bob Armstrong. Savage nails Jim Cornette, who's just made his way to the apron. Savage again going to that top rope. He's going to try and finish the Bruiser off. Watch out, here comes Dory Funk. He shoves Randy Savage. Savage down as Mark Curtis checks the eyes of Bob Armstrong. What's the Bruiser going to do? The Bruiser's got the knucks out. One good hard right hand, two and a three. With an assist from the brass knucks, Bruiser Bedlam nails Macho Man Randy Savage in a series of events. Cornette throwing the powder, the referee checking Armstrong, Savage having Bedlam pinned, but the Bruiser getting the knucks out after Funk had pushed Savage down. And watch now, Armstrong trying to help Randy out. Down goes Funk. Another shot to the Bruiser. Whoa! Cornette hooked in the sleeper. Bedlam rips at the eyes of the Bullet. What are they going to do with him here? Parachute him. Dumping him onto that top rope. Savage up. Drops the Bruiser. Goes after Funk. And we've got a Donnybrook on our hands. The match technically, officially is over. The winner is Bruiser Bedlam. With a brass knuck shot at Randy Savage. Look here. Savage's got Cornette in the corner. And is he in trouble? Funk with a tennis racket. Drops Randy Savage. Drives a knee into the side of the head of Bob Armstrong. So the Cornette group in command now. Bedlam and Funk going to work. Armstrong, the knee into the midsection. Savage down. Funk stomping away. Savage in trouble. They're going again for Armstrong. Dropping him onto the knee of Dory Funk Jr. Savage unable to help out. Look here. Look here. Bedlam to the top rope. He can. Tracy Smothers. Smothers into the ring to help out.
Smothers considers Bob Armstrong like a second father, and he's here to protect the family. Smothers and Savage going to work. Arms is down, and Cornette and company hit the road.
Scott and Steve Armstrong, Bob's sons, join the fray to uphold the family honor against Cornette and the Funk Brothers. But once again, things got out of hand.
The handle right into the back of Scott Armstrong. You got to feel sorry for this kid. He has been battered all around the building tonight. And still yet to make a tag. Terry Funk sets him up for a pile drive. No, it's a power bomb. Here's a cover. Count of two. Looked like for a moment it was going to be a pile driver. Instead, Terry Funk goes for a power bomb. Now he's going for the neck breaker, which he connects on. Covers him up. Count of two. Again, didn't hook the leg. And Scott Armstrong once again is able to get out. Now he rolls him up. Count of two. Oh, my. You talk about a move out of left field, and Scott Armstrong was almost able to pull one out. You wonder how Scott could even have the mental capability of remembering to do something like that. Dory Funk with a second forearm. There's a third. Scott Armstrong, by all intents and purposes, should be out on his feet here. Battles back with a right, not much behind it, though. Tries again, still in that corner. Dory Funk is teeing off. Scott Armstrong just trying to come up from his toes and power out here. What a great display by Scott. Dory Funk Jr. fighting back. We got it going in the corner. Scott Armstrong connecting, though. He's starting to wear Dory Funk Jr. down. And Funk is down on the mat. Can Scott come over and somehow make the tag? He needs to desperately make this tag. He's been in the entire match so far tonight. Dory Funk is off the ropes, and both men there are down. Scott needs to make that tag. Bob Armstrong with words of encouragement. Jim Cornette trying to get Dory Funk to make a tag. He does to Terry Funk. And there, Scott Armstrong makes the tag, and Steve Armstrong is in, unloading. Right hand, right hand. There, Terry Funk with a headbutt, another, and another. And Terry Funk, also a little worse for wear. Steve Armstrong unloads with a right. Follows it up with a couple of lefts. And a big roundhouse right. Over to Dory Funk Jr. as well. Terry Funk doesn't know where he is. Steve Armstrong and Scott Armstrong are both in. A little double teaming by the Armstrong brothers. Down on the mat goes Terry Funk. Dory Funk is in. He's going to get the same treatment here. Jim Cornette now finds that Bullet Bob is able to land one on him. Meanwhile, Terry Funk is being double-teamed. Bob Armstrong working over Jim Cornette. Mark Curtis, though, has his back turned to what's going on in the center of the ring as Bullet Bob continues to unload and Cornette right into the ring post. Dory Funk and Bob Armstrong are going. Meanwhile, Terry Funk is tied up. There's a big flying drop kick by Steve Armstrong. Terry Funk is covered. Here comes Bruiser Bedlam in. Mark Curtis doesn't see that Terry Funk is tied up. He doesn't see. Tracy Smothers is in. Now comes a tennis racket. Dory Funk has a tennis racket, and he unloads on Steve Armstrong. And Mark Curtis never saw any of it. Now he turns around and sees Terry Funk. Oh, my. Terry Funk is able to cover up Steve Armstrong, and the Funk brothers get the pin. You got to know, though, that if Mark Curtis hadn't been distracted to all what was going on between Bullet Bob and Cornette and the others, Smothers and Bedlam, that the Armstrong brothers would have won this match. What a crime. Into the corner. And Smothers climbs it up. A left, a right, a left, a right, left, right, left, right, left, right. And Bedlam staggers out of the corner. And Smothers puts him down. He's ready now for that jawjacker. Tracy Smothers climbing up. Ready to go for the jawjacker. Here comes the wild-eyed Southern boy, and Bedlam is able to get out of harm's way. Bruiser Bedlam is able to get out of the way. Here's Cornette helping Bedlam with a chair. And Tracy Smothers missing the jawjacker, not able to get up. Smothers trying to reach for the chair, can't do it though. Bedlam with a body slam, oh no. The back right on the top of that chair. Now Bedlam will help him up again. And once again, Smothers right onto that chair. Bruiser Bedlam now going outside the ring. He'll climb up the ropes. He'll go to the top rope, ready to unload. Here comes Bedlam. Oh, my! Tracy able to get out of the way. Cover and a count of three. Count of three. And the wild-eyed Southern boy, Tracy Smothers, is able to get the Duke tonight on Bruiser Bedlam, who landed headfirst on that chair. But Smothers now feeling the wrath of Cornette. And here come the Funk Brothers in. Terry Funk, what's he got? Some sort of pole. Unloading on Tracy Smothers. Almost looks like a branding iron, if you will. Smothers is helpless, wide open. Dorian Terry Funk and Bruiser Bedlam teeing off on a helpless Tracy Smothers, who got the win tonight, but now looks like he's going to pay the ultimate price. 3-on-1. Something's got to break here for Tracy Smothers. He needs help badly. 4-on-1 now. Here comes Bullet Bob Armstrong. Bullet Bob Armstrong with a baseball bat, and he lands one right to the pit of the stomach of Bruiser Bedlam. Home run by Bullet Bob.
To return to the ring, Bob Armstrong would have to resign again as commissioner. Cornette thought if this happened, he'd be able to take over again. Bob resisted, but finally, his hand was forced.
He's taking a tremendous pounding, but again, he shows you that he's in top-notch condition. From behind, good, beautiful. Three.
Got him. Yes.
Tracy. Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of the match, Tracy Smothers.
Wait a minute. There's Bruiser Bedlam into the ring. Quickly to attack him. What the heck is going on?
Well, there's
Bruiser
three against
came
one.
In, not three. Cornette is in. Smothers is down.
What's happening here?
Oh. Atkins, he's going to go down.
Chris Hamrick trying to help
right
out.
Yeah,
yes.
No way.
Kyle is covering the corner. Let's see what's going to happen here.
Santo.
Yes, here
he
comes James Atkins.
Kyle is in the ring. You got Cornette in there with that tennis racket just pounding away.
Cornette.
Nobody can get into the ring now for the enforcer. Kyle, he's just laying them low
exactly.
Every time anybody gets them on the apron.
Cornette and Bedlam are having their way, and Kyle's covered them. Oh, let's see what's going to happen.
Here come the Armstrongs.
Yes, sir.
And the Armstrongs quickly into the ring.
And you've
Cornette
got
it. Cornette goes out. We got Bedlam. We got the enforcer.
Here comes.
We got the Armstrong.
Candida. Brian Lee.
Brian Lee in.
Miss Tammy's down at ringside.
It's crazy in there. Les,
it's insane. We've almost got a full-scale battle royal
Everybody,
on our hands.
Where are they all coming from? What's happening with them? It's chaos.
Armstrong and Bedlam in the ring. We got Armstrong
in. They're fighting out.
Here comes Bob Armstrong.
Tammy Fitch is even spraying again into the face of Scott Armstrong.
Here comes the bullet.
Here comes Bob Armstrong. Armstrong in with a big right hand to Killer Kyle. He floors Cornette with a right.
The commissioner's
Bob
dictating
Armstrong,
policy.
Down goes Cornette again. He's got Bedlam up against the ropes. Down goes Cornette.
Steve
again.
Armstrong's being doubled on the floor. Scott Armstrong is down.
God, they're fighting in the ring, they're fighting out of the ring, they're fighting all over the gym. They're everywhere.
Uh-oh.
Now Bob Armstrong being held in.
Cornette gets a shot at the bullet, and again.
A tremendous blow from that racket.
And another
right
one.
Across the midsection. And now he's going to take his coat off, I guess, to get a little more into it.
Oh, look at this.
Is this Brass Knucks?
Yes.
Brass Knucks right under the top of the
drops
head.
Drops him. He drops him. And, of course, while they're in the ring, both the Armstrong brothers are on the floor being handled by Brian Lee, Chris Candido, and others. Let's see what's going to happen now. And of course, Bob is down. Wait a minute. Here comes the R&R, Rock and Roll Express. They're going to hit the
and
ring.
And again, we got a ring full. Rock and Roll come in.
Seems like we've got every wrestler within 100 miles
in
this ring.
Now, Bob Armstrong, Scott, and Steve Armstrong. They've been pounded. They're outside of the ring. The bell keeps ringing. Somebody's trying to get
Lee and Candido up now.
Here's Candido back in.
Wait a minute. Watch. Bob.
There goes
Armstrong. Is headed
he's leaving. Wait, he's never walked away from a fight in his life.
I go back.
Where the heck is he going?
I don't know. I
he's
go back a lot of years
in
this day.
He's walking right out.
He must be confused. I've never seen him walk away from a battle in his life.
And every time someone gets out in front of Tammy Fitch, she sprays him in the eye.
Look at the union boss. He's up there just having a field day, tennis racket, hitting people. Enjoying it. And well, the commissioner's on his way back.
Well, we said he'd never run away from the
fight.
Here
comes the bullet.
He's got a baseball bat.
He has got a bat. He's got a bat. Down goes one. Down goes another one. Down goes a third and a fourth. Bedlam down. Kyle down. Everybody down.
Boy, he's clearing house with that baseball bat.
All right, we're in the ring with Bob Arm. Bob, before I go up, you and I go way back.
Yeah.
But tell me, hasn't this thing gotten a little out of hand? I mean, this is a bit much, Bob.
I'll tell you this much. Cornette says he's got a lust for power. Well, I got power in that right arm with a Tennessee toothpick on the end of it. Now, he's talking about a union. I've heard all night I got a lust for power. I want a union. Well, you can forget Armstrong's army because tonight, right here, we are going to form the People's Union for the people, by the people, and with all the people you see around me. They want violence. They got violence because this right arm may go ballistic, brother. Target being your nose, Cornette. We have had enough. Enough is enough. And I'm going to grant you your wish. I'm going to step down.
What?
I'm going to quit right now. I will not be commissioner anymore because I'm going to be where I belong right in this square circle. I know exactly what I'm saying. And I'm going to tell you what. Call your mama and tell you she'll rule the day that she united with the jackal and you were born, brother, because you will never, never forget this day because me and this Tennessee toothpick and everybody you see me have had it to the hilt. We've had it up to the neck from on, brother. Eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth, and by God, I mean it with every fiber of my being from now on, brother. It's eye, tooth, and anything you want from now on.
And there you have it.
The stage was set for Armstrong to lead the People's Union against Cornette's Union, F-I-T-E, fight. But on whose terms? And who would be involved? This was soon to be revealed.
And you have some stipulations for this match, right?
That's exactly right. I have got stipulations. But as usual, so did Jimmy Cornette.
That's
you
right.
Don't ask him for something. He's not dumb. He's just plain stupid. But he's got to have his way about things. And I did want a coward wave the flag match, but he said, I won't do that unless you do this.
Well, you know, we've got a videotape of Jim Cornette. And as you say, you want something, you've got to give something in return. Right now, let's look at that VCR and see what Mr. Cornette has to say.
You know, I've finally, after long last, gotten exactly what I wanted. Bullet Bob Armstrong has resigned as the commissioner of Smoky Mountain Wrestling. Effective August the 5th, he'll no longer be the commissioner because he wants to get... Oh, hold on a second. Union headquarters. Well, if he's not getting the job done, fire him. His wife's pregnant. Well, fire her, too. They're obviously not doing enough overtime. All right?
Yeah.
Anyway, as I was about to say, Bullet Bob Armstrong wants to get back in the ring. He wants to get a hold of the union so bad, the Federation of International Thugs and Eliminators, that he's willing to sacrifice his commissionership to get back in the ring. And I have this communication, as a matter of fact, from him here on my desk that says that he wants a special match because he wants to take Tracy Smothers as his partner because we've done so many terrible things to Tracy. And he wants to have a six-man tag with Dory and Terry Funk and Bruiser Bedlam. And I said, well, wait a minute, two of them, three of us, that doesn't add up. But then they said he wants a mystery partner to be involved. So then I got started thinking something's up Bob Armstrong's sleeve. And then I got this piece of paper here, this contract. What he wants is he wants a Coward Waves the Flag match, the match to end all matches with Dory and Terry Funk and Bruiser Bedlam against Bob Armstrong, Tracy Smothers, and whoever this mysterious partner of his is. Well, Bob Armstrong, I don't know who you think you are, but I'm not born yesterday, brother. You were born it last night, and you're still in the dark. As a matter of fact, let me explain something to you. Jim Cornette has conditions on everything. Jim Cornette gets what he wants. So I put a few clauses in the contract, and the only way that I will sign it is if there's 2 6-man tag team matches. Because if you get the kind of match that you want, then we get the kind of match that we want too. That's the only way I'll agree to it without knowing who your partner is. So basically this, since your retirement is effective August the 5th, then that's the way that the thing's going to turn out. August the 5th, Knoxville Civic Coliseum, the Night of Legends. Can't think of a better place because you're an old fossil, Bob Armstrong. It's going to be a Coward Waves the Flag match. Bob Armstrong, Tracy Smothers, and whoever their partner is against Dorian Terry Funk and Bruiser Bedlam. You know how the match is over, Bob Armstrong? Yeah, of course you do, because you asked for it. But I'm going to remind you one more time. The match is over. Not in anything that happens in the ring. Not if somebody's leg gets broken and they give up. Not if somebody gets pinned. Not if they submit. Not if anything happens in the ring. No, the guy standing outside has to wave a white flag. That's the only way that the match can be over. I don't know who you got waving your flag, Bob Armstrong, but I don't care about my men's health. So I'm certainly not going to wave that flag because I don't want to lose. But then our match, the one that we want, the following night, August 6th, Fire on the Mountain, Johnson City, Tennessee. It's going to be a Texas death match. That's right, Armstrong. The Funk family invented them. It's simple. There's no rules. You get in there and you fight with everything you got. If somebody gets pinned, they got 30 seconds, and then they can pop right back up and you wrestle again. It could go 4 falls or 40. The only way to win the match is to beat your opponents down so bad that they can't continue and they wave it off. So you see, a Texas death match is right up our alley. So we get what we want, and you get what you want. And I still want to know who you're turning the commissionership over to, and I also want to know who this mystery partner is, because none of that is specified in this contract. So I'm still going to keep my eye on you, Armstrong, but that's it. They're calling it double trouble. Twin six-mans, August 5th and 6th. One for us, one for you. Let me get that idiot back on the phone.
All right, we've heard from Jim Cornette, and here's the way it stands. On Friday the 5th in Knoxville, you get your Coward Waves the Flag match. But in return, because especially of the Funks is a Texas death match, Fire on the Mountain in Johnson City on Saturday the 6th, they get a Texas death match. So it's your shot on Friday, their advantage, if you will, on Saturday. Double trouble, Bob. But here's what I want to know. Of course, Cornette is going to be the coward in the corner with the flag on Friday night.
You got it. You got it.
Who's going to be waving the flag for the team of Armstrong, Smothers, and the mystery partner?
Well, I'm glad you mentioned that, because when we thought about who we needed in our corner for a flag man, Tracy and I thought about the same man at the same time. Right, Tracy?
You're exactly right, Bob. And he's the toughest, the orneriest, the meanest man that the good Lord ever put on this earth. If one of our arms was cut off, this guy wouldn't wave the flag. And, Bob, we both had the same guy in mind, right?
Exactly right. He's a man who's put knots on my head, and I got scars on my face to prove it. He's the meanest man to ever come out of the Smoky Mountains. And why don't we bring him out right now and let everybody have a look at him? And I'm talking about none other than Mr. Ron Wright himself. He believes in no pain, no gain, exactly. And by golly, he won't wave that flag like he said. If somebody gets a finger bit off, this man knows about pain. He's dished it out. He's taken it. He knows all about it. And he's the man we want in our corner, because we don't want the match stopped. And by golly, I think Ron's the man to do it. Right, Ron? How you doing, Ron?
How you doing? Nice seeing all you people. It's been a while. Now, let me tell you something, Mr. Thatcher, Mr. Armstrong, Smothers. I'll guarantee you, you've picked one of the meanest men in the world, got the worst temper and the honorest, and I'll tell you one thing. You better not get in there and think that I'm going to wave this flag for any reason. It don't matter if they take your head off or what, because this flag won't wave. I'm going to take this flag. The reason I've got it tonight, I'm going to take it with me. I'm going to take it and dip it in concrete, and it'll be wrapped up solid in concrete like a cask to where it's impossible to wave it. And the only thing I might have to do with it, if Jim Cornette gets his nose up there and gets in the way, I might use that concrete flag around his head.
Amen.
You boys take care of business, and I'll be in the corner with the flag, but it won't be waved, brother.
You know, you guys, I know you guys are planning on making this one of the worst night in Mr. Cornette's history.
Absolutely.
But you know, we've got some videotape of what may have been the very worst night in Jim Cornette's career.
You're
it was
right.
In 1986, you were there.
1986, Starcade,
exactly.
At the Omni. I was there. You were there. We saw what happened, but nobody else did. Let's let them take a look,
heard
Ron.
About it.
Let's go to the VTR of the Starcade 86.
Up here,
high over the ring. Oh,
bad night, and you say it's going to be worse on August the 5th.
That's exactly right. It's going to be worse, and if I have to take this Smoky Mountain toothpick and take care of him, we will. I got the meanest man as our flag man, Tracy Smothers, and now it's about time I told everybody.
You know, I said earlier to Bob Connell, I said, this is, and it's eating at me, I want to know who is going to be the third man on the team of Armstrong and Smothers.
Well, that film should have given you a hint. I'll tell everybody right now, the third man on our team is going to be none other than Road Warrior Hawk.
All right.
And you know what Hawks do to rats, don't you, Les?
Yes. You know, we've got a camera in the dressing room with Jim Cornette. I would love to have a monitor where I could see the expression on this man's face right now, because you're right. Now, maybe he's the second meanest man to the one standing right here.
Oh,
would be Road Warrior
Hawk. I thought he might have kept that
seat. No.
Hold on now. Hold.
There ain't nothing you can do about it, brother. There ain't nothing you can do about it. Come on in here and I'll light you up.
Ladies and gentlemen, time has come for tonight's main event. It's a six-man Coward Waves the Flag match. A unique and a very dangerous match. Les, explain the rules to us.
All right, Jim. Well, quite simply, there is only one rule, and that is to win, your opponent's corner man has to wave the white flag of surrender. Other than that, anything goes. But before we go to the ring, let's get the comments from the two teams.
Well, it's all on the line tonight. This is make or break Jim Cornette Day, and I've got the biggest, baddest, most legendary assemblage of wrestling talent ever put together under one roof, the Funk Brothers and Bruiser Bedlam. And I guarantee you, there ain't a coward around here, and I ain't going to wave no flag, Dory. No way.
No way, Mr. Cornette. You're not going to wave the flag. And I want to say this. This is one of the most important wrestling matches to take place in not only the United States of America this year. This is important all over the world. There are people from Japan, from around the world, watching for this six-man tag team match to see what happens. I take it very serious. There's a fellow on the other side that I don't care for, and I think you know that's Bullet Bob Armstrong. I wrestled him a long time ago, and I really don't care for his partners either. But this is an important one, and we're going to go for the win. We're not going to waste it.
That's exactly right. And Terry Funk, I know that you're not going to want to quit. No way, no way. You're not going to ask me to wave that flag, are you, Terry?
Cornette, back up a moment. Oh. That is the damnedest outfit that I have ever witnessed in my entire life. And you have dressed for the occasion.
That's right.
Because you have an admiral's or a general's outfit, and that's what we need. Because what is necessary, we are going to the ring. It's his discretion whether the white flag of surrender should be waved. What I say is throw the flags away. Let's go get them. Let's go, guys. Let's put our hands together and let's get out
there. Oh, yeah.
Hey, hey,
yeah. Hey, 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 hey. I don't care about nobody and I ain't gonna wave no flag. Let's go get them, boys.
You know, we've walked, we've talked, and the BS has been flying. Well, it's all over and it's time to get down to business and get the job done. You might say, where's Ron Wright, the man that waves the cowards and waves the flag match? He's so mean, he won't even talk to the three of us. But we are ready for you, Jim Cornette, and your outhouse union. You've surrounded yourself with human excrement. Now let's see if you can dig your way out tonight.
Jim Cornette, like we said before, your union is busted. We got a guy right here that darn near killed you in the scaffold match. It's too wet to plow and it's too windy to haul rocks. So we can't get along and we're going to get it on. There's no cowards right here. We're coming to fight. Cornette, Bruiser Bedlam and the Funks, you're going down, and that's the bottom line.
What about it, Union Buster?
Well, goodness gracious, mercy my. We're just about to enter the ring, which is good for us and bad for Funks and bad for Bedlam and bad for Cornette. The simple difference is, they care. We don't. You care about Mom. You care about Dad. You care about Aunt Eileen if you got one. You care about your hamsters. I had hamsters. Used to feed them to my boa constrictor just for kicks before I'd sit down and beat someone else up. You know what, Cornette? You little crankbait. You get my face, and I'm gonna slap the sequins off that stinking Suit your way, Buck.
Oh. Can we get a AED?
No time limit. No disqualification. No count out. The match continues until either Cornette or run right way the coward flag.
Look at here. And if it's going by rounds, it looks like Armstrong and company have won the first one.
Terry Funk and Dory trying to, they're taking the rails down, those steel rails, throwing them in the ring. Oh, Cornette headed for high ground. They're fighting out here, the fans.
They are all over this arena floor, and look at here, Terry Funk and
Hawk. Oh, look at him right on us here, right on our table. Funk slams the Funk's heads together. And Terry Funk takes the seat right by left. Funk hit the face with a bell. All hell is broken loose.
I couldn't get a better seat. I had Funk in my lap. And how are you going to call this one? We've got a mini battle royal on our hands here, Jim.
I'm going to be surprised if the ring stands before this one is all set and done.
And look here. JC has been cornered, and coming to his rescue, Dory and the Bruiser.
They're fighting again on the outside. Remember, no count outs here. Hawk's on the outside. Cornette in the ring. He will Hawk drop kick Bruiser Bedlam out of the concrete floor. Dory Funk ran into the steel by Bob Armstrong. Bruiser Bedlam's got another steel chair. Tracy Smothers nailing Terry Funk. My God, they're fighting all over Knoxville, Tennessee tonight.
You're absolutely right. You know, and unless somebody's been in a monastery in Tibet, we have four people here who are legitimate legends. Cornette even mentioned that. The Funks, Hawk, and Armstrong, and the Bruiser and Tracy Smothers aren't far behind.
Well, I don't envy the referee here.
Do you think he's got... Oh, look at Funk.
Terry Funk going for a ride. He'll be singing acapella, soprano, in the shower tonight. And Armstrong caught him with that clothesline. Missed right to the face by Hawk on Dory Funk Jr.
Tracy on the high end.
On the top rope, right down on Terry Funk. Dory Funk with a vicious uppercut. And this is chaos. Nothing but chaos.
Funks for the very first time trying to regain some semblance of control here. And they may have it with Bullet Bob now as they take Smothers on the outside.
Oh, Funk's got a chair. He's got that chair. Tracy Smothers. Oh, he popped him right in the head with that steel chair. He nailed him with it. He hit him right in the face with a chair to Terry Funk. And Tracy Smothers is down on the concrete.
Cornette is floating now, but I think it's a little premature.
Oh, Smothers ran again into the steel ring post, head first. Cornette kicking away. Remember, there's no disqualifications here. This is a brutal, brutal match. Pinfalls don't count.
Once again, we might reiterate to the fans, the only rule is that one of the corner men must wave that white flag of surrender. Otherwise, anything goes. The referee cannot disqualify any of these wrestlers.
Tracy Smothers has been busted open at the hands of Terry Funk in that steel chair that caught him flush in the face. Now it looks like the legal men, and I use that term loosely, will be, oh, pile driver. Terry Funk pile driving Tracy Smothers. How much more can Smothers take?
He has been split open, and Terry takes the tag, and now we're playing.
Oh, look at that. Oh. Flat while it's tilted. Left hand. Terry the Southpaw. Terry Funk, the wild man from West Texas. The Funker has him up and he planted him. He drilled him with a pile driver.
And now Terry Funk doing what he does best. Just pounding on another man. Bruiser coming in, and this is the first time I think we're really seeing any semblance of teamwork from these guys.
Oh, shoulder breaker. They're trying to take Tracy Smothers apart. and they're doing a pretty darn job, good job of doing it.
See how, now listen to Cornett. Did you see that? That cackle coming from him.
Oh, he is really happy right now. Everything is under control as far, oh no. The Bucks got Tracy out, and this vicious, they drove him. They didn't just drop him, but they drove him into the steel railing. And he can't do that. Don't pile drive him on the concrete. Mike pile driver right here on the floor, right in front of us. They could have broken this kid's neck.
Look at there.
Well, I'm not so sure that just out of this kid's career sake, Les, they should go ahead and wave the flag here.
Again, I have to be in agreement with you, Jim. Dropping him on that concrete floor, head first, they could have jammed that spine right on down. Compressed it, something fierce. But look at him, Tracy's coming up, and Arms is talking, waving him on.
Corey Buck saw Tracy's brother back in the ring, and there to meet him was Bruiser Bedlam and Terry Funk. Bedlam now, hard, inverted atomic drop, compressed his spine there, and Bruiser Bedlam makes another tag to Terry Funk, who drives a toe in his wrestling boot right into the ribs of Tracy Smothers.
Terry going for that hang.
He got him with it. They're working on this kid, Tracy Smothers' neck. They pile drove him on the concrete floor. I'm not sure Tracy Smothers even knows where he is. Cornette said they're going to make him wave the flag.
I'm going to tell you what, knowing Ron Wright the way I do, somebody's going to have to go over there and grab his arm and shake it back and forth, Jim. I don't believe he'll be waving that flag for any reason.
Well, I've heard of his vaunted reputation in this area. There's a double-arm suplex by the former NWA champion. Many say the greatest NWA champion of all time, Dory Funk Jr.
And you know, maybe that's the key to Cornette's trio here, the fact that the Funk brothers have wrestled in tandem for so many years, that might be the key to them winning it if they're going to win it at all, Jim.
I think there's fans here that want Ron Wright to wave that flag, but he was shaking his head no. I'm sure he made a vow to these men that he would not wave that flag. And look at this, great strength by Bruiser Bedlam, standing vertical suplex, and they make yet another tag.
Shut up!
They're having a field day with Tracy Smothers.
Here's what I'm curious about, since they can't pin him. They suplex this man enough and he cannot stand up. Where do we go from there if he cannot make that tag? There's only one way to get him out of there, and that is to wave that flag.
They're trying to put him in such a bad position to incapacitate him that Ron Wright will wave that flag, another double arm suplex, and Tracy Smothers is in a desperate, desperate state. I'm not so sure he even knows where he is right now.
Dory and Terry going to use that patented Funk double team.
Oh.
And Terry.
He made the tag. He made the tag to Hawk. Road Warrior Hawk in. A first man. Military pressing. Terry Funk. Sid Bruiser Bedlam for the ride. Caught him in the shoulder.
Woo. And the Hawk man has opened the door for his team. And what a way to do it. Watch him go to that top rope.
This will be all right here. He'll take his head off. Hawk up on the top and cuts off with that clothesline.
He's going to get that.
He's choking him out.
I started to say he's going to get that pin, forgetting there is no such thing in this match.
Uh-oh, what's Cornette doing? Cornette sneaking up on Ron Wright. Ron Wright on the scene.
Whoa,
powder right in his face. Ron is blinded. Cornette's got his flag. He's waving Ron Wright's flag.
He's in their corner, and if the referee sees the hand, there's a chance he could put a stop to it. Wait a minute, Wright's up. What's he going to do?
Ron Wright is up. And all right here. Ron Wright knocks Jim Cornette down. Cornette now's got the flag back. Ron Wright with right hand, tumbling Jim Cornette. Cornette waving the flag.
Look, he tried to hit him, but he is waving the flag, Jim. As he tried, look, the referee says.
The referee saw it. Cornette was waving the flag. Cornette can't believe it. He waved the flag. And Ron Wright throws Cornette in the ring.
Cornette realizing his mistake, but too late.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of the match, the Hawk, Tracy Smothers, and Bullet Bob Armstrong.
Cornette now thrown to the Lions here. He waved the flag. His team has lost.
Look at here. We got an aftermath, and his team catches a big surprise, and their manager flying into their faces. What a match it's been, Jim.
There you see the winner. Hawk, Bullet Bob Armstrong, and the Wild-Eyed Son of Mark Tracy's brother. Cornette has been foiled again.
I'll tell you something, Les, what a night we have seen here. New Smoky Mountain Wrestling Tag Team Champions, Ricky and Robert, the Rock and Roll Express, have done it again.
That's right, and of course, that great, great effort by the Thrill Seekers in their match against the Heavenly Bodies.
Les, I can't tell you what a great thrill it has been for me to be here in Knoxville and a part of this wonderful night of legends.
And Jim, for myself and all the fans in East Tennessee and Knoxville, thank you for bringing your expertise, your professionalism to the play-by-play. I've enjoyed working with you. And for those of you out there who watch us on videotape, who couldn't be here in person, we thank you, and stay tuned to Smoky Mountain Wrestling, because the best is yet to come.
So long, everybody.
Hope you enjoyed this program, but wait, there's still more Wrestling Gold. Lots more. Log on to WrestlingGold.com or call 1-800-331-4077 for your free catalog.
No matter what happens to me from here on out, I've already had the worst night of my life.